Number 13, Kansas, taking on number 19, South Florida. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough, along with Chris Spielman. We'll be joined by Rob Stone in just a moment. We're delighted to have you with us for this much-anticipated early season matchup. Last season, Chris, these two teams were the talk of college football, both pleasant surprises. Each rose to number two in the country. This year, job one proved that that was not a fluke.
Yeah, you and I were talking earlier in the day about this is a credibility game for both programs. What I mean by that, you establish credibility in the college football world by doing it over a period of time against other good teams in different conferences. Well, this is their night to shine. Also, to send a message to the Big 12 that Kansas is for real, and to send a message to the Big East that South Florida wants that title.
There are a lot of similarities between these two programs. First and foremost at the quarterback position, each of these teams led by a small but very talented signal caller.
Yeah, let's start with Todd Reese out of Kansas. Now, Todd's a very bright quarterback. What I love about him, he knows what to do with the ball. He completes 77% of his passes so far this year. Has great footwork within the pocket. When you're 5'11", you need that. On the other side, you've got the tough, gritty Matt Grothy. Matt Grothy had 14 runs called for him last week against Central Florida. Look for that to continue tonight. And Sean, he also knows how to distribute the football around the field.
And he has a raucous home crowd on his side tonight as the South Florida Bulls take the field before what is expected to be a near-capacity crowd of better than 50,000. Since they joined the Big East 4 years ago, the Bulls are 15-3 here at Raymond James Stadium. And this place is loud. Down on the field, here's Rob Stone.
Well, Sean, if you're going to build a football program from scratch, you have to have energy. USF head coach Jim Leavitt, no shortage of energy. You see him in pregame running all over the field, talking to his teams, talking to the special groups. If you saw him running out on the field, I think he lapped a couple of cheerleaders, and you say to yourself, man, how does this guy get so much energy? Well, here's one of the reasons why, Sean. I learned today Coach Leavitt's two basic food groups consist of, are you ready?
Yes.
Cheetos and Pepsi. Goes through about a 12-pack of Pepsi a day, and the equipment staff is told when he arrives in the locker room, there are to be three 16-ounce Pepsis and two Hershey's chocolate bars waiting for him. I can't figure out where he gets all that sugar high.
No, hard to imagine. He'll probably be able to fall asleep sometime around Tuesday night. Jim Leavitt and his Bulls ready to go as they host his old pal Mark Mangino and the Kansas Jayhawks. The opening kickoff in just a moment. There's George Selby, the All-American defensive end for South Florida. His numbers are way down from where they were a year ago.
Well, two things about that. Why? Because he's not going to sneak up on anybody. So he's seen a lot of double and triple teams. Tonight's going to be tough duty because Kansas gets rid of the ball so fast. But I'll tell you what, as far as effort, I have found no one, at least that I've watched play, that plays with the motor that he plays. He'll give you 100% all day, every play. And the other thing is, with all the attention that he gets on the defensive side of the ball, the other fellas, especially Jared Bowie on the other end, have to step up and make plays with this South Florida defense.
Saw Selby in action last week in their overtime win over Central Florida. Jim Leavitt said he played about as well as you can play in that game, despite the fact he didn't have great stats.
I agree with that, Sean.
Kansas won the toss and elected to defer, so South Florida will receive the opening kickoff from Jacob Brandstetter, a transfer from Air Force. He just became eligible prior to last week's game. A shutout win at home over Louisiana Tech. Both teams are 2-0, each open with a very easy win. South Florida opened at home with a win over Tennessee Martin, 56-7, while Kansas opened in Lawrence with a 40-10 victory over Florida International. So the sternest test for each of this young season, and it's underway. Torres Johnson fielded the short kickoff at the 13-yard line and made it to the 33. Harris Wright, who lost his helmet, managed to make the tackle. It is a 21-yard return. The quarterback for South Florida is Matt Grothy, the junior from Lakeland, Florida, coming off one of the best games of his career. in the win last week in Orlando over Central Florida. He's from Lakeland, about 35 miles away.
So Mo Clancher getting the starter running back tonight.
And he goes straight ahead. Out to the 36-yard line. It is running back by committee behind Matt Grothy. You'll see the starting lineups at the top of your screen. Clancher has emerged as the leading rusher, in part because of ankle injuries to Benjamin Williams and Mike Ford. The status of both of those young men as of yesterday afternoon when we met with the coaches was unknown. Grothy slings it, and it is caught by Jesse Hester Jr. a couple of yards short of the first down at the 42-yard line. A gain of 5. Let's take a look at tonight's Jack Lynx impact players. Clancher figures to be their leading rusher.
Yeah, then you move to Cedric Hill, the tight end. Watch for him in the red zone. Both staffs rave about Cedric Hill. And Jacob Stim stepping in at guard tonight has to be a physical player.
His first start for Zach Herman at right guard. Herman broke his foot earlier this week in practice. Grothy on third down completes for what should be the first down. A.J. Love had forward progress out to the 45, and that's where they mark it before he was driven back by Chris Harris. It's a 4-yard gain and a first down for Grothy and the Bulls.
Well, this is when you're working the backside of trips, and all it is a 3-step hitch route. And if you're going to stop this, you got to get up and press, especially on third down and 1 or 2. Get up and press and challenge him. And talking to the coordinators for both teams, they want to do that tonight, play man-to-man and get in the grill.
Clancher, the lone back, and he goes ahead for a couple. He was their starting running back 2 years ago, but was injured in the opener and has been fighting his way ever since to get back to being the featured back.
Well, the reason why they have featured backs, they also count on Matt Grothy, as we mentioned in the open. Last week against Central Florida, 14 runs for quarterbacks last week, and Matt is like an extra tailback in that backfield.
That's how the Kansas coaches refer to him. He's a tailback at the quarterback position. The line gave him great time, and he throws a deep ball, too deep, over the head of his intended target. Looking for Cedric Hill, the tight end.
That's a excellent job of protection, and he missed Torres the Bull. Torres the Bull's on a deep post route right here, and Matt had all the patience. If he would just look down in the middle, throw that deep post. Instead, he had a guy open in Cedric Hill, but he missed him. That's a blown opportunity, but something that they might exploit. Cedric Hill on a linebacker. I think South Florida takes that matchup all day long.
Well, like a lot of tight ends, really a wide receiver in a lot of their sets. For the first time tonight, no score, nearly 3 minutes played, and here comes Kansas, led by the junior from Austin, Todd Reising, off to a tremendous start this year. First and 10 from their own 29 with 4 wide receivers, 2 to each side. A heavy rush and a shovel pass. You'll see a lot of that from the Jayhawks, and this one's good for nearly 12. Jake Sharp with a first down. Reising from Austin, Texas, not highly recruited out of Lake Travis High School, largely because of the fact he's only 5'11". And he's had a tremendous season, 77% completions, averaging 334 yards passing per game. They saw that one coming. Damon Patterson smothered behind the line of scrimmage by Tyler Roberts.
That's one way to stop the screens. There's a blown blocking assignment by KU right there. Tyler Roberts, not hesitating, runs through the tackle, keeping his eyes on the potential receiver as opposed to the ball, making a solid stop behind the line of scrimmage.
Loss of 5 Reising might be changing the play. And an option look, and it's Jake Sharp again for about three. Like South Florida here in the young season, Kansas has been running back by committee, and they've had a difficult time getting the run game going in their first two wins. A look at tonight's impact players for Kansas, brought to you by Jack Links.
We have Desmond Briscoe, great with run after catch. The backup quarterback slash receiver, Curry Meyer, consistent hands. A guy they want to get going. Jock Crawford, look for him in the ball game to start running the football.
Third down and long, and the crowd wild early. Tim Beery, the tight end, went in motion. Reising's a good runner. He has a long way to go. Needs to get to the 50. And ducks down a little bit shy of the 50. Jim Leavitt out on the field. He hates the spot. Looks like where they spotted it is right on that yellow line for a first down. But Jim Leavitt saying, wait a minute, John Bible. His knee was down. He was down shy of the 50-yard line.
Well, the pressure came up top from George Selby. Took two guys. Here's George up here coming up top. Watch two guys go to him. And George will chase him down. They lose contain on the backside. And Todd Reising showing his toughness. I think he got it, Sean. I think that was a good spot.
Yeah, he was heading to the ground, but I don't think his knees were on the ground. I think he did a very good job, Chris, of ducking below the hip, but not putting his knee down on the ground. Well, there his right
there you go.
Might be down there from the original angle. It didn't look like it was.
I think Jim Leavitt has a point.
So they convert on third and long, and it's first and 10 now from midfield. And the quick pass is batted down. Intended for Kerry Meyer, who has 18 catches in the first two games. Terrell McClain, a defensive tackle sophomore out of Pensacola, batted it out of the air.
Now that's one way to defend the quick passing game, that 1.5 seconds where they want to get rid of the ball in a quick three-step. Forget about the pass rush. Get in your throwing lanes once you read three-step and hands up. Now, if you're an offensive lineman, you cut his knees to get his hands down.
Two backs now as Jock Crawford joins Sharp right behind Reising. Then he looks to the sideline for guidance. And it's a pitch to Sharp. In trouble behind the line. Managed to break through a tackle. Then he got lit up by Bruce Mompremier, the fifth-year senior out of Miami, making his 16th career start tonight. The coaches say he's not real fast or flashy, but he's one of those guys who's always in the right place.
Just a good job. Tyler Roberts, first of all, misses the tackle, but when you have hustle and speed like the South Florida Bull defense, pursuit will always win the battle. I thought Coach Leavitt could have challenged that with the spot of the football. Something to keep your eye on right there if this drive continues.
Third and 7. Just a four-man rush. Reising for another first down to the tight end, Tim Beery. His first career catch for the true freshman out of Omaha, Nebraska. It's good for 10 yards.
Watch at the top of your screen. We're talking about the double play of George, the double team of George Selby. He's coming. You see Jock Crawford and the offensive tackle take care of him. The problem is there's nobody doing anything else for the South Florida defense. So you can't bring pressure with four. You better start bringing five, or Reising will pick you apart all day long.
Wally Berman, the defensive coordinator for South Florida, says Reising is the most accurate passer they've faced in his 9 years here at USF. He's on target early tonight with another one. A short throw and a catch by Jonathan Wilson. He breaks free down the sideline. Touchdown, Kansas.
Shot, we were watching film. You made the point of how well Kansas runs after the catch. Right here, you see it with Johnson. Now watch the poor tackling. Head behind the ball. Let me duck and I'll miss. Let me try to tackle you by the foot. No deal.
Jacob Brandstetter adds the extra point. 36-yard touchdown play, racing to Jonathan Wilson, the sophomore from Houston, Texas, with his first touchdown of the year. Jonathan Wilson, his first career touchdown, 36-yard reception, capping a 71-yard drive that was kept alive on third down and 12 by a scramble by Todd Reesing and a questionable spot of the football in which he got the benefit of the call.
See right there, his knee is down, and Jim Leavitt has to pull that flag because it ended up hurting him. Other than punting the football, they take it down for six.
It was right in front of Coach Leavitt, and he was pointing at it from the get-go. Here's Torres Johnson returning the kickoff. And he's down at the 31-yard line. Tackled by Micah Brown. 19-yard return is Rob Stone.
Well, Sean, running back a question mark for USF coming into this game. Right before kickoff, I talked to the running back coach, Carl Franks, and he said, you know, we plan to go about three, maybe four deep today. If you don't see a running back in the first half, you're probably not going to see them at all. Asked him about the name player, Mike Ford, ankle injuries. He's, you know, very skeptical look on him. But for the first time right now, we see Benjamin Williams out there at running back.
He's also playing with a gimpy ankle. Quick pass to Torres Johnson, coming off the biggest game of his career. He had 143 yards receiving in their overtime win at Central Florida last week. This one good for a 5-yard gain for the senior from Cape Coral on the southwest Florida coast near Fort Myers.
Greg Gregory said they'd like to get him involved early. The way to get him involved, not only kickoff returns, but throw the little swing pass so he gets some confidence and gets excited about the game.
Matt Brophy, it looked like a design run, nothing there, so he just ducks down back at the line of scrimmage.
It's a good decision by Matt. That's the key to this offense and the key to this South Florida football team. You don't want to take any unnecessary hits, and you're surrounded by three big trees. Go ahead and take a knee and get a 1-yard gain as opposed to taking a chance on getting hurt.
There's Greg Gregory. The left of your screen, the offensive coordinator coaches the quarterbacks. The backup quarterback, Grant Gregory, is his son. Brophy under duress. It pops in the air, and it's caught by the running back, Benjamin Williams, but he's only back to the line of scrimmage. Mike Rivera, the linebacker, was blitzing, and it looked like he got a piece of the arm of Brophy or the football and forced that one to pop right up in the air.
Let's take a look at this, because I felt, and we'll see it on the replay, I just had a feel that the Matt could have stepped up into that pocket because it was collapsing on the outside. Step up and buy yourself some time to throw the football.
Albert Alvarado on the punt, the junior from Tampa. Right, a shank on his first try.
Dead ball foul. False start. 45 on the offense. That's a 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Jim Leavitt said yesterday when we visited, we've been terrible in the kicking game. They've had difficulty covering punts and kicks. Put a few more starters out there, and they've tried to simplify their coverage techniques. Another short kick and a fair catch made by the true freshman, Damon Patterson. 36-yard punt. Time for tonight's timeline, brought to you by John Hancock. As we noted earlier, these teams surprised a lot of folks last year. Kansas picked to finish fourth in the Big 12 North, wound up tying for the Big 12 North with Missouri. While Jim Leavitt's squad got up to a great start, an early win at Auburn, got ranked for the first time. Kansas, meanwhile, went all the way to 11-0, ranked number two. At one time, South Florida was 6-0 and ranked number two. Then they lost three straight, finished 9-4. Kansas 12-1. They won the Orange Bowl. Jake Sharp straight ahead. Meanwhile, South Florida was hammered in the Sun Bowl by Oregon. And Jim Leavitt said that was a great motivator for his team in the offseason.
Well, again, I think they want to prove that they're going to be a team that's going to establish some tradition, a tradition of winning. And you have to do it no matter when you play or where you play. They didn't handle the success as well as the players would have liked to last year.
We're seeing a good ball fake. Throws it in the flat. And Wilson, the touchdown scorer, got hit hard by Tyler Roberts.
Ball marked at the 39-yard line, about 5 yards shy of the first down. They were 6-0, and as Jim Leavitt said, rolling in three straight Big East losses. Took them out of contention for a BCS bowl game and the Big East title. They did rally to win three in a row to end the regular season, and a lopsided loss in El Paso. The goal this year, win the Big East and make it to a BCS bowl. Five and a half to go, first quarter. Another third down for Kansas, and another conversion on third down and five. It's Wilson right through the heart of the secondary to the USF 39. 23 yards, first down, Kansas.
You see Jonathan Wilson coming out of his stance and working in between the linebackers and safeties. And I'll tell you, that's a nice throw by Todd Reesing. You see why his number one trademark is his accuracy. Not an easy throw to make under duress.
It was 61% and change last year, and that's not bad, but they want it to be much higher in this short passing attack. Kerry Meyer the catch in traffic. And that's his game, the short possession type receptions. This one goes to the 33. Reesing much more accurate early this year than he was last year.
He throws it in between two bull defenders, and right there, Carlton Williams, if he gets his right arm to swat the ball, play the football, don't play the man, he has a chance to knock it down. But the more you let Todd throw the ball, the more confidence he gets when he makes those tough throws, just like he did.
He's 7 out of 8. He's now 8 out of 9. Damon Patterson, the speedy freshman, stacked up just beyond the line of scrimmage. And it'll be another third down. They're 3 out of 3 on third down tonight. Here's Rob.
When we asked Kansas offensive coordinator Ed Warner why they wanted to increase Reason's completion percentage, he said, hey, you know, we got to challenge the guy with something. You know, they have a manager track every practice play of his, and they've done that since August. The goal, an 80% completion rate during teamwork, 90% in 7-on-7 drills. He's above both of those right now.
8 out of 9 tonight. Third down and 3. Kansas leads 7-0. And a completion for a first down to the 21-yard line to Desmond Briscoe. You can see the approach that the South Florida defensive coaches were talking about. These linemen and backs for Kansas are going to chop to get those defenders on the ground and give Reesing a better throwing lane, better vision.
Yeah, here's the goal shot to get the ball out of his hands at 1.5. Right there, they're at 1.6, which is good. And you have to be able to play defense man-to-man coverage if you want to make that work.
Jock Crawford, the ball carrier. First year at Kansas as a junior college transfer out of Cisco Junior College, where he was the JC National Offensive Player of the Year last year, rushed for over 1,900 yards. He predicted before this season he would rush for 2,000 yards this year. He starts the night 1,951 yards shy of that goal.
Well, I think humility is a motivator for a young running back getting his first taste of FBS football.
Second and 5. Kansas already up by a touchdown, marching again here in the final minutes of the first quarter. Again, just a 4-man rush. And Meyer, acrobatic catch, inbounds, shy of the first down by a yard. Meyer is the backup quarterback. He started against South Florida quarterback in Lawrence in 2006 when the Jayhawks won 13-7, the only other meeting between these two schools.
Yeah, it's interesting. In his meetings, he spends 40% of practice with the receivers and 60% with the quarterbacks. But obviously, he has the perspective from the quarterback position on how to run routes. In good hands like that, solid receiver.
Third and short. The pitch to Sharp. He's in trouble. Made a couple of nice moves to get back to the line, but he's still a yard short of the first down. And you saw George Selvey in hot pursuit all the way. Nate Allen up from his safety spot as well. And it will force a field goal try from Jacob Brandstetter. KU has not missed a field goal this year at 5 out of 5. Brandstetter in his first game last week against Louisiana Tech was 3 for 3. None of them longer than 30 yards, and this one is right about at 30. And it is good. Just inside the right upright.
The score, Kansas
So racing is 10 out of 11. The Jayhawks are 4 out of 5 on third down, and they lead 10 to nothing. We're looking at the library on the South Florida campus, and they tell us, Chris, that the library, particularly the fourth floor in the Special Collections Department, is haunted. There's a ghost nicknamed the Phantom of the Fourth Floor. Doors just mysteriously open. Sometimes books are tipped over, knocked off the shelves, and there are those who believe in it. There's a Ghostbuster t-shirt in the library the other day.
Yeah. I watched Ghost with Demi Moore and Patrick Swayze today, so I believe that, so it's probably true.
Todd Racing off to another great start, trying to get his name involved in the Heisman Trophy mix. 6 for 6 on the last drive. And his team is up 10 to nothing. Horace Johnson took the short kickoff. Got his helmet knocked off. He got walloped by Jake Shermer. Let's send you back to our studio right now. Here's a Sports Center right now. Reese, thank you. It's Mo Plancher on first down for South Florida. Ahead for about two. He was tackled by Caleb Blakesley, a defensive tackle.
They're trying to establish the ball on the ground, but that's twice that Torres' helmet has come off. And now we're getting in dangerous territory. Get your helmet fixed and don't let him come back into the game, because we're talking about helmet popping off two times. That's too many.
Matt Grothy. Short throw, incomplete, too short for Jesse Hester, the son of the former Florida State wide receiver who went on to play in the National Football League. Jesse Hester Sr. got 373 passes in his NFL career.
See, the ball's one hopped right there. And there's no rhythm with South Florida's offense. We're seeing two different offenses, one in rhythm, one not in rhythm. And right now, the green and gold have no rhythm. Like me dancing.
There's an apt analogy. Four wide receivers. Grothy with a lot of time. Steps up and has a man open. First down and much more. All the way to the 37-yard line. A.J. Love. Sophomore from Bradenton. Tackled by Justin Thornton after a 29-yard gain.
This is all about patience on the quarterback. He'll have Jesse Hester sitting underneath, but he's short of the sticks. Just let A.J. do his work down the field. Be patient. You see the quarterback Chris Harris not get his depth, jump the underneath route. A.J. running the 7 route, Matt delivering a strike on the 7 route.
4 receivers to the right, and they throw a quick hitter there, but the Jayhawks rally to the ball and drop Torres Johnson to the line of scrimmage. James Holt, the tackle, senior linebacker. It's a veteran linebacker core and one of the best in the country, with Holt and Mike Rivera on the outside and Joe Mortensen, a first-team All-Big 12 linebacker in the middle.
Yeah, big guys, about 558 pounds between Mortensen and Rivera.
Five-man rush this time, and they get to Grothy with it. And a flag down. Crowd thinks it's a face mask as they applaud. Jake Laptad took him down, the sophomore.
That's a 15-yard penalty, first down.
But it was a face mask. And a costly one at that. Negates the sack and gives the Bulls a first down, moving into Kansas territory.
They just run a nice little X stunt where the defensive tackle comes outside, and basically it's like basketball, Sean setting a pick, and Laptad comes right underneath and accelerates through the hole. He's got to be conscious. I know it's hard, but when you hit a quarterback, go ahead and hit him low. That way you avoid the head all the time.
It is the end of the first quarter. Todd Reising was outstanding for Coach Mangino, and the Jayhawks on the road lead South Florida 10 to nothing. Mike Ford has committed running back for his first carry of the night. Playing on a sore ankle that kept him out of last week's game against Central Florida. He was tripped up after a short gain, tripped up by Darryl Stuckey, who's had a great year so far at safety, and one carry and Ford limps off.
Yeah, you saw right there. I think he got his foot tangled up a little bit, and he gave it a test. And as soon as he got up, Sean, he looked to the sidelines and gave the head shakes. I can't go. And as a running back, if you can't run 100%, get out, because you embarrass yourself and embarrass the team. Good decision by Mike.
Five wide receivers. Grothy on second down. Dumped it over the middle, incomplete. Looking for Cedric Hill.
Pass intended for number 9, Cedric Hill.
Justin Point was there to break it up. The junior free safety from St. Joseph, Missouri. This Kansas defense has not given up a touchdown yet this year. The only touchdown scored against KU in two games was by Florida International. In the opener, the Golden Panthers scored on a punt return for a touchdown.
And the biggest reason is they got veterans and solid players on all three levels. Defensive line, linebacker, and secondary. All of them are well coached.
Third and 7 from the 24. Five-man rush picked up, but Grothy's throw is errant over the head of Taurus Johnson.
Grothy's pass incomplete. Fourth down and 7.
Thornton again involved in the coverage. Last year, Kansas, the only team in the country ranked in the top 5 in both scoring offense and scoring defense. They're off to the similar start this year. Maikon Bonani, the new place kicker, true freshman, trying his first career field goal. A 41-yarder. And that never had a chance. Hooked well to the left. He's from Lake Wales, Florida, in Central Florida. And the kicking woes continue. He replaced Delbert Alvarado, who was just 1-for-4 this year on field goal attempts. And now Bonani, who grew up in Brazil, is 0-for-1 as a collegiate kicker. All state out of Lake Wales High School in Florida as both a punter and place kicker last year.
Well, a lot of times when you try to, you're excited and that adrenaline's flowing as a kicker, it's almost like a golf swing. You come over the top a little bit and almost try to swing too hard, and you'll pull the football or the golf ball. In this case, it was the football. I think he was trying to drill it just a little bit too hard.
Still a 10-0 lead for Kansas, coming off a 29-0 shutout over Louisiana Tech last week. Jake Sharp carries and gets wrestled down to the 27 by Carlton Williams, the fine, strong safety. Well, Chris, I don't know if you know this, but your alma mater has a football game tomorrow night. It's been dubbed the Collision in the Coliseum. It'll be on ABC. Jim Tressel's fifth-ranked Ohio State Buckeyes take on Pete Carroll's top-ranked Trojans in the most anticipated game of this season. Saturday Night Football, brought to you by Southwest Airlines on ABC Saturday at 8. Also available on ESPN Radio.
Be a different Ohio State team than last week.
Racing throws a little bit too long in the direction of Desmond Briscoe. Jerome Murphy had the coverage. Well, it's been about 8 minutes since we had an update on the stats of Danny Wells, the most talked about toe in the history of our country. Right now, I guess he's doubtful.
Well, I don't know if he's doubtful or not doubtful. I don't know if it's gamesmanship going on by Coach Tressel.
Oh, no, he wouldn't.
But no, but I know this, with him, they're an excellent football team. I believe an elite team. Without him, they drop down to a very good football team, which might not be enough to compete against SC's defense.
Another third down. They're 4 out of 5 on third down tonight. Racing, running for his life, and throws, and it's dropped. That should have been another third down conversion, but the freshman, Damon Patterson, dropped it. Coverage by Nate Allen. But once again, Reising did his job very well. He's so elusive and has the ability to maintain focus down the field while scrambling.
You know, Sean, I was trying to figure out who Todd Reising reminded me of, and I go back to my favorite football team as a kid, the Minnesota Vikings, and Fran Tarkenton. That's who he's in. He's Fran Tarkenton reincarnated. Good job of throwing across his body with a lot of arm strength. Even though small in stature, he has a lot of arm strength.
Alonzo Rojas to punt, sophomore from Miami. And a nice booming nose up spiral. Marcus Edwards didn't get very far to the 27. A 6-yard return of a 51-yard punt. Tom McDonough, Chris Spielman, Rob Stone back in steamy Tampa, Florida. The folks are, of course, relieved that Hurricane Ike moved away from this direction, but we do have tropical humidity. And certainly we're all keeping our fingers crossed for the folks along the Gulf Coast in Texas. Matt Grothy on target to Ben Busby, listed as the third string tight end. Quality gain, 13. First down out to the 40-yard line.
Good job.
4 degrees right now. Pardon me, Chris.
That's just a good job of reading the different levels. They jumped the flat route. Busby coming across over top, finds the open area in the zone and sits down and waits for Matt to throw the football.
Grothy turned 22 years old earlier this week. Has another open receiver and another first down. To the Kansas 44 goes Dontavia Bogan, sophomore from Thomasville, Georgia. Chris Harris made the tackle. They have great depth at wide receiver. Greg Gregory says this guy might have the most talent when you combine all of his athletic skills.
Well, he just runs a little post corner right there and cuts the corner off. Again, Matt Grothy throwing the ball downfield, and that will loosen up the secondary of the Kansas Jayhawks.
Jayhawks crowding the line. Quick toss to Carlton Mitchell, who's been a sprinter on the USF track team. We got about five dancing along the far sideline while in the grasp of Chris Harris.
And Greg Gregory said he believes he's the fastest player in the Big East, the 400 meter man, which is a very difficult race. And so they want to get him the ball, obviously in space, to see if he can make something happen.
Greg Gregory, longtime assistant coach at Army, for over a decade at West Point. Out in the flat, Taurus Johnson back across the line, and that's it. Darryl Stuckey up from his safety spot. Matter of fact, I mentioned the similarities between these two programs. The two offensive coordinators, Greg Gregory and Ed Warner of Kansas, spent 11 years together on the same coaching staff at Army, working in the same office space under Jim Young and Bob Sutton. And they are good pals. And obviously they learned from the same folks.
You got to think that they were by themselves drawing up some spread offenses, because I don't know if Army was running a spread back then.
Pretty much option football in those days. Five-man rush for the Jayhawks on third and four. Hester has the first down. Fighting for extra yardage. There's a flag down behind the line of scrimmage. It's going against Kansas.
Penalty, first down.
I think they roughed the passer again. Big 12 officials, that's Kansas's conference, and Big East folks in the replay booth tonight.
Let's see here. He's got good pressure. This time Matt Grothy does step up into the pocket, and Jeff Wheeler has to do a better job of pulling off. You don't need to do that. You got to be aware, especially, you know, in a big game like this, they're going to call it a little close to protect the quarterbacks, which is the nature of college football and pro football. Unfortunately, let them get hit.
South Florida trying to get on the board here in the early moments of the second quarter, down 10-0. Grothy a design run, and they were ready for him. Joe Mortensen, the middle linebacker, with the first pressure. John Larson also in on the play. Here's Rob.
Well, guys, they're not afraid to run Grothy because they have great faith in their backup quarterback, Grant Gregory. But it's not to say they're not trying to take care of him. I talked with USF's equipment manager yesterday. They said, hey, man, we've been trying to get this guy in a flak jacket and one of those hex pad shirts with the pads built in. He keeps shaking it off, saying it throws off his rhythm.
Trying to throw on rhythm here, and he threw it away. It'll be third down and 12. I spoke with Matt Grothy yesterday. He said he was still sore from last week's game. It's a very physical game at Central Florida, very emotional game. The two schools are close together. And he said Central Florida was the dirtiest team he'd ever played.
Well, they had, what, 7 personal fouls, and he said he was taking shots after the whistle. Another thing, we talked to him, he was up to 220 pounds in the spring. He's 190 pounds, so obviously he doesn't have the cushion that he had in the springtime, but he's a better football player at 198 than 220.
Cushion was too much pizza, and Aziza too much Chick-fil-A, so they got him in better shape. It's Says he feels quicker and he thinks his arm strength is better as a result. He said he was starting to have back spasms because he was carrying too much weight. Timeout called by Grothy. Grothy had an interesting week. Last week in the game at Central Florida, turns out that some of the Central Florida students got a hold of Matt Grothy's cell phone number. Over the summer, he had put his truck, which we saw yesterday on the campus, for sale on Craigslist and included his phone number. So that made it around, and he was getting hundreds of phone calls and texts. There was a banner in the student section last week with Matt Grothy's phone number. He had to change his phone number this week.
Yeah, you know, some of those messages were pretty rough, but he also admired some of the creativity of the Central Florida fans and laughed it off, but obviously he changed his phone number. But that's what happens. That's the internet and all that stuff that gets out there. That's what you're in for.
Yeah, we asked him to share some of that creativity, but he said it wasn't suitable for a national TV audience. Let's check in with Rob.
All right, you're talking about Chick-fil-A. This is his special. He would order the number 5. It's hard to hold. The large sweet tea, the 12-piece chicken nuggets, and the large fries. 1,040 calories, 46 grams of fat. Just to make sure he doesn't have it, I'll take care of it on the sideline for him.
We're not worried about your weight. Grothy throws on third down, deflected and incomplete. The linebacker Mortensen dropped right into the passing lane, and he's disappointed he didn't pick it off. But it forces another field goal try.
Well, this is what a veteran linebacker will do for you. He'll get his depth and understand route recognition, breaks with the receiver, and because he has enough depth, he's able to undercut the deep dig by Jesse Hester.
Rob has some endorsement deals. I think he had two products in our on-camera open. Now he has Chick-fil-A.
Yeah.
There's Bonanni for his second try. He missed earlier his first career attempt from 41. This one's right in the middle. First one was from an angle, and that kick is a lot better. Same guy, just a bit more experienced. .958 to go. First half. It's now a 7-point lead for the Jayhawks. Beautiful Loudoun, New Hampshire. Todd Racing. Thrown for 100 yards. Started 10 out of 11. He's missed on his last two pass attempts. He'll throw on second and two and complete it. For the first down to Jonathan Wilson. He's from Houston, Texas, Klein Forest High School, and you have to imagine he has a lot on his mind tonight with Hurricane Ike heading toward his hometown.
Yeah, I'm sure he does, and a lot of times you have him escape on the football field, and a good job of throwing a touch pass over Jarrett Bowie, who's pulling off of his pass rush to try to defend against that quick passing game. If he's going to do that, he just needs a little bit of depth and get his hands in the throwing lane.
Todd Racing. Pump fake and then the deep ball and the man is open, and it's Jonathan Wilson with his fifth catch of the night. Stopped at the 10-yard line. They're going to mark him out of bounds back around the 14. Taken out by Tyler Roberts. 56 yards and a huge night for Wilson, who had a 36-yard touchdown earlier in this game.
Well, they set this up, Sean. They ran that little quick screen earlier in the ball game. Right here, they saw him all day around. Tyler Roberts made a stick, and the first time they ran it, this time he jumped it, and Jonathan Wilson off to the races with Nate Allen in pursuit. Great play call by Ed Warner, offensive coordinator of the Jayhawks.
First and 10. Play clock down to 5. Racing calls a timeout.
Kansas. That's their first timeout of the half.
Career game for Wilson. 5 catches, 123 yards. Mentioned he's from Houston. And the impact on football is certainly not particularly important given the magnitude of Hurricane Ike. All the other aspects of life that will be affected. But many college football teams have adjusted their schedules. Arkansas and Texas had a mutual off day on September 27th, so that one was easy. Times of some of the other games moved up. And the Astros, who are red hot, postponed. The Ravens and Texans moved to Monday night. And we keep our fingers crossed. Of course, when Ike was starting to be tracked as it made its way toward the Gulf, Tampa was in that cone of possibility, and the folks here breathe a big sigh of relief.
Well, I was wondering if any of these coaches call Les Miles or
coaches that in the Mississippi area or in the Florida area to get how to handle your football team under these type of circumstances. I'm sure that'd be a viable source of information.
First and 10, the South Florida 14. Kansas leads by 7. And Crawford got bopped by Terrell McLean. Mentioned Crawford said he'd rush for 2,000 yards, but he has since realized that the transition from junior college to this level is much more difficult than he thought. Much better level of football, and we got a lesson on how hard they get hit at this level as well.
Right there, McLean did a nice job. And Kansas offensive running game has been inconsistent all year, and they'll feel that will get better with time as this offensive line grows together.
Second and 10 to the end zone. It is deflected and incomplete. It looked like if Damon Patterson had let that go, Jonathan Wilson would have had a touchdown. You can't blame Patterson. He probably thought it was intended for him. It's unusual to see two receivers that close together, but if he doesn't touch it, don't you think Wilson's going to catch it?
I thought the ball was intended for Wilson, and I'll bet you that Patterson runs the wrong route. In fact, I think he's too deep. He's got to cut that off underneath to give Wilson room to work in the end zone.
Third and 10. Racing in the Jayhawks. 4 out of 6 on third down tonight. Midway through the second quarter, it's a 7-point game. Racing steps up. He tries to run and won't get anywhere near the first down marker. Tripped up at the 10-yard line. George Selby was in pursuit. Aaron Harris tripped him up. Jared Bowie fell on top of him. Almost a little bit too late.
It's a good job of Jerome Murphy taking away Briscoe on a deep cut. You see Jared Bowie diving over the player, a non-intentional hit, and good thing he took his head out of the way, because if his head would have hit Reesing, that flag would have came down, rightfully so.
Randstetter, 4 for 4 this year, all of them 30 or under. This one's 28. And good, they're 7 for 7 in field goals this year. And it's back to a 10-point lead for the Jayhawks of Mark Mangino. Sean McDonough, Chris Spielman, Rob Stone, our producer Josh Hoffman, our director Mike Roiger, outstanding ESPN crew. Delighted to have you with us from Raymond James Stadium, Tampa, Florida. Number 13, Kansas, with 13 points on the board, leading 13-3. Taurus Johnson. A great kickoff coverage by the Kansas Jayhawks. Just a 13-yard return. Micah Brown and Aris Wright down there in kickoff coverage. Here comes Matt Brothy. 12 out of 18 for 91 yards passing. He hasn't been able to find a running lane. -2 yards rushing tonight. He's third in the history of the Big East Conference in rushing among quarterbacks. Almost 1,600 yards rushing in his career. Only Pat White and Rasheed Marshall of West Virginia rush for more all time in the Big East. And that isn't going anywhere fast. Marcus Edwards smothered by Chris Harris. Brothy was their leading rusher last week with 54 yards at Central Florida, moved past the great Donovan McNabb of Syracuse into that number 3 spot in career rush yards by a quarterback in the Big East.
Yeah, and Kansas has done a great job of taking away the called runs. Two have been called tonight, and Kansas was not fooled at all. And what that tells me is their bigs are beating South Florida's bigs to the punch and getting off blocks on any type of run that South Florida has attempted.
Loss of 4, 2nd and 14, batted ball, incomplete. Knocked down by Mike Rivera, the outstanding junior linebacker from Shawnee Mission, Kansas, one of 4 team captains.
Lynn Bowen, the defensive coordinator, made the point that he has NFL ability, and I know he has NFL size. It's 6'3", 255, and moves really well for a linebacker that big. Usually you don't see him that big in college football. He plays outside, he can play off the ball, on the ball.
3rd and 14, Brothy takes off. And get shoved out of bounds. After just a 2-yard gain, Chris Harris ran him out. And the crowd getting a little restless with a very uninspiring performance by Jim Leavitt's offense so far tonight.
Yeah, I was just going to make that point, Sean. You notice it, I notice it. They seem flat. I don't know if it's the heat. I don't know if it's coming off of a tough intrastate win last week against Central Florida, but they're flat tonight.
Albert Alvarado to punt. To Damon Patterson. He's already returned one for a touchdown this year, 75 yards against Florida International. He had to let that one bounce, and it takes a good roll for the Bulls. 49-yard punt. Now time for our wild play of the week, brought to you by Jack Links. And we harken back to that game Chris was speaking of in Orlando last week. USF UCF, a rivalry that's ending to the chagrin of George O'Leary. And it's ending with a South Florida win in overtime as Matt Grothy found Taurus Johnson, 25 yards. Having a big day for both Grothy and Johnson. South Florida blew a 14-point fourth quarter lead in that one. Jim Leavitt in part blamed himself, so we're a little greedy in the play calling. We didn't do a good enough job of protecting the ball in the lead.
We want to run the football, take some clock out.
Todd Reesing handed off to Jacques Crawford. Terrell McClain made the tackle. We talk about Reesing as a fringe candidate right now for the Heisman Trophy, but certainly somebody off the year he had last year. With the start he's up to this year, who could emerge? This is one of the smartest players in college football.
Yeah, and I think all depends on how Kansas does. Obviously, if Kansas makes a run through the Big 12 like they did last year, then he's certainly going to be there, at least in the top 5 or 6 Heisman candidates at the end if he continues to put up the numbers.
Reesing gets it off and has his man, Kerry Meyer. Inbounds, it's a catch to the 39-yard line of South Florida. 24 yards and another first down, and another accurate throw by Reesing, who's every bit as good a student, if not better, than he is a quarterback. Graduated early from high school, Lake Travis in Austin, with a weighted GPA of 4.2. Get back to that in a moment, but first back to the action. And here's Briscoe with a run after the catch and a fumble, and then Kerry Meyer was in the right spot. And the play goes all the way to the 17-yard line and another first down.
Well, again, an example of run after catch right here. Briscoe gets the ball, and you see the block downfield by every Kansas player within the pitcher. Meyer's down there getting the block.
22-yard gain. They're threatening to take a big lead here late in the first half. Crawford over the middle for 10 more, very near another first down. Bruce Mompremier made the tackle.
You see the exhaustion setting in on the Bulls defense, and what they're doing is they're changing up the snap count. They're going up, hurry up, and they're running the screen plays outside and inside, which is essentially the running game, and it keeps USF's defense off balance.
It is first and goal now. With 4 minutes to go in the half. Reesing with an excellent fake. Gets inside the 5. And he went out of bounds near the 3. He's a double major, economics and finance, on pace to graduate in 3.5 years, December of 09. He's a 3.7 student. He says it's not as high as I'd like it to be, certainly in high school, when you graduate third in the class of 375, you're used to it performing at a better level than 3.7.
Yeah, his favorite magazine is the Economy magazine. It's keeping track of the finances of the world.
He carries copies of The Economist in his backpack. He's going to run the same play. Touchdown. An economy of effort for Reesing. Beat George Selby to the corner of the end zone, and it is all Kansas on the road here in the first half.
Yeah, right here, George Selby gets a little bit nosy inside. You can't do that. You have to be a disciplined player. When you know you have contained, stay there. They know that George Selby likes to chase the ball. They sucked him in. Todd just pulled the ball from the running back and beat him with the speed to the corner of the end zone.
Jacob Brandstetter kicks the extra point. Well, we talked at the top of the telecast about these two teams trying to make a statement. Riesing and the Jayhawks are. Well, the Jayhawks want to prove a point tonight. Last year was not an aberration. They are a program on the rise and here to stay. And Todd Riesing with a chance to get the attention of those who cast a vote for the Heisman Trophy. Last year he got a letter from the Heisman Trophy Trust telling him that he was one of those players under consideration for the award. He kept that letter, gave it to his parents, Steve and Debbie, as a Christmas present. They keep it on display in their home. Dontavia Bogan, the kickoff return to the 31. And here's our award winner, Reese Davis. We never want to miss what Dr. Lou has to say. Statue in Lou's honor being unveiled in South Bend this weekend. Matt Brophy trying to get this offense on target. And that's a good start in that direction with a strike to Taurus Johnson. Justin Thornton made the tackle, but it's good for a 24-yard pickup and a first down for South Florida at the Kansas 46.
What I love about both quarterbacks is they do not get rattled, and they're not afraid to throw a guy open. That means throw the ball into coverage, trust your arm, trust your accuracy, and trust your teammate to make a play.
120 yards of offense now for South Florida after a 24-yard gain. Brophy to Jesse Hester. First down to the 33-yard line. Pulled down by James Holt. 13 more for the South Florida Bulls.
Well, that's a matchup they'll take all day. You have Jesse Hester on linebacker James Holt. There's no possible way that James can stick with him. But what James does have to do is not let him beat him across his face inside, which Jesse did. Game over.
Five wide receivers. Movement. Flags down.
Flags on the play.
A free play right there. Took a shot. Just wasn't on the same page with Carlton Williams. Mitchell, excuse me.
Offside. Defense number 47. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Maxwell Onyebule, the junior from Arlington, Texas. Guilty of the infraction.
Good response so far by South Florida's offense, knowing that they need something to stay in this ball game.
Brophy with time. And he throws incomplete. Looking for the tight end, Cedric Hill, along the hash marks with Chris Harrison coverage. We've seen a lot of this tonight as well. A lot of gesturing back and forth among the members of this offense.
Well, you're going to do that when you have a three-man rush. You see Joe Morrison come on the blitz, but they're kind of mirroring Matt Brophy. They're not worried about him throwing the ball so much. They want to make sure that they have any rush lanes closed down, as they did on that play.
Second and five. Brophy, nice cut. First down inside the 20. He may go. Touchdown, South Florida. Kansas coaches say he's a tailback at the quarterback position. They showed his running skills there. 28 yards. First touchdown given up by the Kansas defense this year. And Mikon Bonani adds the extra point.
Tell you, a great block by Cedric Hill, and the running back skills, as you mentioned, it's about his vision. You're going to see Cedric Hill set it up right there. Thornton takes a bad angle. Then Matt Grothy uses his speed and beats Thornton to the end zone. But when you have vision like a running back, Matt Grothy can make it work. They just did a little play action ride. It's just a little counter play. And got a good blocking downfield by his receivers and sprung by Cedric Hill as tight end.
Grothy from Lakeland, Florida. Just a little bit east of the Tampa Bay area. Loves to fish. He ideally loved to host his own fishing show on ESPN. Prefers saltwater fishing. He'd also like to teach and coach when he gets done with his football career.
One thing about him is his composure. He never gets rattled. Even the coaches talk about this. Even when their team gets down, the guys look to him to bring them back. And right there, that was very important for this football game, for them to get points on the board, especially six.
Justin Tichy will kick off. Damon Patterson and Marcus Perford back deep for Kansas. 2:14 remaining in the half. Perford chopped down at the 20-yard line. Inspired special teams. Cameron Perkins again, the senior from Pensacola. Here's Rob Stone.
Well, that Grothy touchdown run actually inspired the Kansas quarterback. He came over here and saying he was dancing, he was popping up. You know, he's got this look that he enjoys this game as if it's a hobby, because as you were talking about, education is really his main pursuit. But he came over to me saying, they are giving me way too much time, with a big old grin on his face. He is having a lot of fun with the USF defense so far.
This is 2:10 to go in the half, two timeouts remaining. Shovel pass. Jake Sharp dropped for a loss of a yard. South Florida also has two timeouts left. Bruce Mompremier made the play. Hastings thrown two touchdown passes tonight.
It's the ability of the receivers to run after the catch, and also his ability to scramble makes you wonder. As a bull, what do I do?
Throw one and run for one. Second and 11. Minute and a half left in the half as Meyer gets banged out of bounds. Short of the first down. Jerome Murphy knocked him out. With two new starting cornerbacks at South Florida this season. Murphy and Tyler Roberts, they were both waiting their turn behind Mike Jenkins and Trey Williams. Both of whom were drafted in the NFL draft this spring. Jenkins in the first round by Dallas. First ever first round pick for University of South Florida. First in their 12th year in existence as a college football program. On third down, Grothy flings it deep. Looked like he was just throwing it away in the general direction of Damon Patterson. Jared Bowie put some pressure on Racing.
Yeah, that's the first really good stop that South Florida has, and it's still a minute 24 left, which gives them a lot of time to work. When they get the ball back, you see Selby and Bowie. Selby coming from this end, Bowie from this end. Jared Bowie getting knocked down, but stays in pursuit and forces the throw away by Todd Reesing.
Well, they knew they were going to get chopped all night, and that's been the case. Alonso Rojas to punt. Oh, another bomb. Marcus Edwards had a drift back to the 25. And he dances to the 35. A 10-yard return of a 46-yard punt.
Great matchup between two fine head coaches doing battle of wits.
Grothy. Deflected pass. James Holt got his fingertips on it. And almost intercepted it. Isaiah Barfield went diving after it. There is a flag on the play. Thrown along the line, the far side of the field.
Kansas does a good job of getting depth with their linebackers.
Illegal shift. Offense. Two players in motion did not get set before the snap. 5-yard penalty. First down.
They don't worry about the underneath routes. They're getting their depth, especially in this situation.
Rothy on first and 15. Dumps it short. A.J. Love got the penalty yardage back. But now they need to hurry. Under a minute to go. Two timeouts left. The clock is running. It'll be second and just over 10.
Start to look for a playmaker. Torres Johnson is a guy that has made plays for them in the past.
Rothy has time again, has another receiver, but it's short. Hester lost the football. Unfortunately for him, it went out of bounds. Holt poked it out, but it went out of bounds and forward. Might have even gone by the first down marker after the fumble.
You see this a lot of times. Try to switch hands. That ball's loose. You have to keep it close to your body. And a good job right there by James Holt of swatting the football and tackling the football. Chris Harris almost had it in midair.
Heard John Bible, the referee, by rule. The fumble comes back to the spot of the fumble. That's the 41. So it's third down and four. And the half is running out. Rothy realizes now that they wind the clock. And he is upset with the sideline. And I don't think Jim Leavitt's all that happy with that. He comes way out of the field to give Grothy an earful.
Now, I think both of them have to be aware, and I don't know if any of them were aware that that clock was moving.
Well, you don't show up your head coaching staff, your coaching staff, and your head coach like that. That kind of gesture is going to get that kind of a reaction from your head coach.
Yeah, I agree. The coaching staff has to be aware of the clock, and both guys got to get on the same page.
Well, it's been a frustrating start to the season for the Big East Conference. South Florida and Connecticut, two games into the season, are the only remaining undefeated teams in the Big East. They're both 2-0, but they both needed overtime last week to remain undefeated. South Florida at Central Florida. Connecticut beat Temple in overtime. We'll see the Huskies next Friday night against Baylor. Rothy in trouble and sacked back at the 35 by Mike Rivera. And now if you're Kansas, would you use your timeout and try to come after the punt?
Absolutely. I would use it. You have nothing to lose. Might as well not go in at halftime with any timeouts. If you got a good punt blocking scheme, take a shot.
Well, he's going to call the timeout. Looked like he wanted to call the timeout. I don't think he got it. Yes, he did. John Bible announcing to the crowd. Kansas called timeout before the end of the half. A lot of the folks had started toward the concession stands.
I think it's a good call by Coach Mangino. Why not? Send your athletes out there, put 11 up on the line of scrimmage, and come get it.
We'll discuss the strategy of how to come after this punt. We mentioned the struggles of the Big East. By contrast, it's been a great start collectively for the Big 12. But here are the problems in the Big East. Pittsburgh is being hyped as a possible BCS bowl team, Big East champion contender. And maybe they still will be, but they open with a loss at home to Bowling Green. West Virginia lost handily at East Carolina. Syracuse is now 0-2. And we're going to breeze right by that. And Rutgers is now 0-2. Two nationally televised losses to Fresno State in North Carolina. As a league, the Big East has only 3 wins against BCS foes. And they're not going to risk the punt. Pass is incomplete. And that ends the half. So good decision by South Florida. Why risk the punt block? Snap it, throw it away, and head to the locker room. So we're at the half. Kansas leads on the road. Here's Rob.
Coach, why so much success today with big plays on third down?
Well, we've made plays. On offense, we're moving the ball pretty good. We're making some plays. We should have converted a fourth down the red zone, but we didn't.
Matt Grothy's touchdown run with about 2 minutes left. How will that affect your talk to the defense?
Our defense is fine. We put ourselves in some bad spots. One of the things we got to do is we got to be able to get to the quarterback with a 4-man rush. And we're not doing that right now except for the last play before the half. So we need to get to the quarterback with a 4-man rush.
Coach, we appreciate you joining us live. Thank you.
Sure. Mark Mangino, like his program, on the move. National Coach of the Year last year when Kansas won a school record 12 games. Back at Raymond James Stadium and ready for the second half. Kansas controlled the play convincingly in the first half. They lead 20-10. Mark Mangino in that jacket has to be as hot as his team right now. It's mid-80s and really high humidity. He's probably the only guy in the stadium who really wants to wear a windbreaker tonight.
I hope he's getting his fluids because it's hot up in this booth. I can imagine how hot it is on the field. And you mentioned it, Sean. The offense for Kansas has been outstanding, led by their quarterback, Todd Reese.
Justin Tichy to kick off for South Florida, and the second half is underway. It bounces out of bounds. A break for Kansas at the 1 yard line. So a good field position to begin the second half for the Jayhawks. The official's microphone is not working. And it's still not working. But they're going to bring the ball out to the 40-yard line, I believe is what he said. Kansas controlled the play in the first half. They had 273 yards of offense to 166 for South Florida. And a lot of work for Jim Leavitt and his staff to do at the half. Their defense really looked like they were lost in trying to figure out how to stop Todd Reesing in this Jayhawk attack.
One, avoid the mistakes on special teams right there. Two, get George Selby involved. If he's not involved in the defensive end, what I would do, Sean, is stand him up and move him around and have him come from different angles so they can't double team him.
Reesing's pass looks like it caught Desmond Briscoe by surprise. Take a look at our game track. Todd Reesing outstanding in the first half. 17 out of 22. Jonathan Wilson scored the first touchdown as he broke a couple of tackles and went 36 yards. Reesing ran for the other. They kicked two field goals. And then Matt Grothy with the only touchdown of the night for South Florida on a nifty 28-yard run, leading his way through the defenders. Four-man rush on Reesing. Steps up and throws. Incomplete. Looking for Damon Patterson.
Here's an adjustment that South Florida's defense has made, at least so far in the first two plays. They're getting up and they're challenging the wide receivers of Kansas, playing a man-to-man. What that does, it takes away the short passing route, and it allows the pressure to get there because they have more time to work, because the corners and the defensive backs are in the face of Kansas wide receivers, not allowing them the short dig and the free get off on the football.
Angus Quigley has come in at running back on third down and 10. Design rollout for Reesing. Selby in hot pursuit, and Reesing forced to throw it away. This looked like a lot more energy from the South Florida defense than what we saw in the first half.
Well, yeah, and I bet you anything that Jim Leavitt said, look, forget the play in the zone stuff. If we're going to win, we're going to get in their face, we're going to come after them, and we're going to press them at the line of scrimmage and make them beat us man-to-man. They didn't make it. You see the press right here? The guys are all over doing a good job of technique, breaking when the receiver breaks, the ball is overthrown, and also pressure from the backside from Selby caused that ball to be overthrown a tad.
Alonzo Rojas the punt. Fair catch signal and made by Marcus Edwards. So it's interesting. I think we've both been so impressed by Todd Reesing, watching him last year, watching the tapes of the first two games this year, and then when you see him again in person tonight. Here's a young man, obviously with a lot of talent. He's about the same size as Doug Flutie, but he says, I really have no interest in a career in pro football. You know, when I'm done, I'm going to go to international studies overseas, come back and go to grad school and get involved in business.
Well, we'll see if that changes. Sometimes pro football can force that to change, but I love his footwork and his quick delivery. The other thing is his arm strength. A lot of his passes, he's throwing off that back foot, Sean, and he's been very accurate with it.
Mo Plancher, first play from scrimmage. of the second half. Good for about 6 yards. Racing was 0 for 3 on that first possession of the second half. Came in averaging 334 yards per game this year in two games. That was seventh best in the country. Brothy couldn't find a hole. James Holt met him and dropped him for a loss of a yard a minute into the third quarter.
I think that's the run that they scored the touchdown on, and Kansas wasn't about to be fooled twice. James Holt playing good sound defense as a linebacker, holding the backside, not over pursuing with the fake.
Brophy throws for the first down. Carlton Mitchell was driven back, but he got six before he was driven back. South Florida converts to the 31-yard line. First down.
One of the best things Matt Brophy can do is use his eyes as an asset. Right there, he looked at Cedric Hill in the flat, and he held his look a long time to draw the defense to the flat. Then he delivered the in cut where the defense was running to the flat, and he used his eyes as a decoy.
Brophy again, a lot of time going deep, had a man open and threw it too far. It's tough to overthrow the speedy Mitchell, but he did.
Carlton Mitchell is incomplete. Second down and 10.
Young Barfield right here, the corner is going to slip. There's that post corner route. Barfield trips, and Mitchell, to me, wasn't on the same page as Matt Brophy. He kind of cut his route short. Brophy thought he was going to take it at a deeper angle, thus the overthrow.
Barfield's a redshirt freshman, making his first career start tonight. Kendrick Harper not available tonight, their usual starting corner. First down and more. Nice run after the catch by Taurus Johnson. He's to the 50-yard line. 20 yards and another first down for the Bulls.
That's a guy they want to get involved. They feel like he's their best playmaker on offense, even though they don't look to him. If he gets involved, he's the energizer for the rest of the receivers.
Taurus Robert Johnson said his mom wanted to name him Robert, but an uncle talked her into naming him Taurus. I guess it's only appropriate that he's Taurus the Bull. Inside handoff. Jamar Taylor breaking tackles and powering down to the Kansas 37. 13 yards and another first down. Justin Thornton the stop.
Greg Gregory, the offensive coordinator, said he's a downright mean football player. And right here, he's running with his mean on. Breaking tackles. Nice job of patience, stuttering through the hole. Then once he sees the hole, he bursts, and one man isn't going to bring him down.
Mars, a sophomore from Lakeland. He gets the call again. And another tough 4-yard run. Justin Thornton, Joe Mortensen in on the stop.
I think what they're doing, Sean, is they're going to set up that little bootleg. Remember in the first half, they hit it a tight end on a crossing route off that play action. That's two times they repeated plays, one to the right and one to the left. They have a bootleg off of that play.
Brophy throws. Diving catch and a good one by Dontavia Bogan. Greg Gregory said, we have a lot of talented wide receivers, but if you had to pick the one guy who would go up in the crowd to come down with the football, it would probably be Bogan.
Right there, doing a good job of catching the ball with his hands. Actually was late coming out of his cut, but those good meat hooks snagged the football.
Brophy. On third down and one, a key play here early in the third quarter. They're down by 10 points. Straight ahead, first down, Jamar Taylor breaking tackles. All the way down to the 8-yard line. Finally taken down by Jake Laptak.
You know what you want to do is to energize your offensive line. Coaches can't always energize the offensive line, but a good tough runner can energize him by bullying his way through the Jayhawk defense and fighting and grinding for any extra yard that he can get. That's what gets people fired up, especially the big fellas up front.
running back by committee, and he's really their fourth string tailback. He gets a breather as Plancher gets the carry. Taylor had carried the ball only 10 times in the first two games of the season. But he has been the spark of this drive to begin the third quarter.
And should you get the feeling, Sean, in the meetings that they want one of these running backs by committee to step up and take hold of the job?
Mike Ford seems to have the most talent. He was highly recruited, but he's hampered right now by an ankle injury. Had one carry and clearly wasn't feeling well. Blanchard running right across the line, and that's it. Richard Johnson there to make the stop. Redshirt freshman from Jefferson City, Missouri. And the Kansas defensive coach is looking for a little bit more from him in the coming games.
They also had eight men in the box, and they just outnumbered the blocking scheme of the Bull offense.
Another big third down. A 5 out of 11 on third down tonight. Third and goal. Grothy to the end zone, incomplete. They want a flag. They're not going to get it. He was looking for Patrick Richardson with Darryl Stuckey in coverage.
This is the best defensive back Kansas has, and he hasn't beat inside, but you see Stuckey got away. I think he grabbed the hips a little bit, slowed the route down. Good protection by the Bull offensive line. They brought five defenders. One-on-one battles, you got to catch that football though when you get your hands on it.
There's a big field goal attempt to make it a one-score game for the true freshman kicking in his first game. 1 for 2 tonight. Missed a 41-yard field goal, connected from 34. This is from 23 at a little bit of an angle. And it is good. So Maikon Banani is starting to get the hang of this college thing. And they're back within a touchdown with a long way to go here in Tampa. Hot and humid night here in the Tampa Bay area. And the game heating up. Kansas looked like it was in control through most of the first half, but all of a sudden South Florida back within a score. Still 9.5 to go in the third quarter as Justin Tichy kicks off for the Bulls. And then an offside on the kickoff, and that might negate a booming kick by Tichy. They continue to make key mistakes in the kicking game.
Absolutely, and all that does is give Kansas an opportunity to create field position. But I was watching that particular side of the kickoff team, and it was a clear offsides, a call that you don't normally see.
Offside, kicking team number 21. It's a touchback. The penalty will be 5 yards added to the touchback spot. First and 10 on the 25-yard line.
Theo Wilson, a junior college transfer from just down the road in Dunedin here in the Tampa Bay area. Well, George Selby, consensus All-American last year. Stats down this year because he's facing a lot of double teams, and he's seeing that again tonight.
Well, that's when other guys have to step up and make plays, especially on the pass rush. They haven't done it.
And a walk off to the 25. And it's Angus Quigley for a yard. He's been their number three running back this year. Here's Rob Stone.
Well, when Selby came off the sideline after their last defensive stand, the defensive coaches really encouraged him. George, you're this close. You're this close to finally getting that quarterback. And Jim Leavitt admitted to us, you know, they really had to take it easy on this week because UCF really beat him up physically, and he plays with such high energy, Chris, that sometimes those stars, man, they got to play by different rules. You got to take care of them.
Absolutely, especially a guy of his talent and effort. He doesn't need to beat the Bulls before he beats the Jayhawks.
Movement and flags.
False start, 74 offense. 5 yards, second down.
Kansas a little rattled on the offensive side of the ball to start in South Florida. I think Coach Leavitt had a little talk with him about getting tough on both sides of the ball, especially on the line of scrimmage at halftime, because they're a different team.
Jeff Spikes, the very talented redshirt freshman offensive tackle, moved They think he's going to be a great player. They have two redshirt freshman tackles and then three seniors in the middle of that offensive line. Racing's pass intended for Meyer. But for Jonathan Wilson, incomplete. Bruce Mompremier had the coverage. And Racing, who was in a rhythm the entire first half, is off the mark. Hasn't had a completion, 0 for 4 in this half.
And it's, again, an obvious position that South Florida loves to be in, third and 15. And maybe George Selby right here can get his first sack of the year.
That's at 14 and a half last year to lead the nation. He led the country in tackles for a loss, 31 and a half. One tackle for a loss this year and no sacks. Racing dumped it off. Angus Quigley tackled well short of the first down by Terrell McClain. And Tyrone McKenzie went on the play.
Very good job by Tyrone McKenzie. George Selby coming through. They're letting him go to the screen pass. But Tyrone McKenzie, being a smart veteran, playing at three different schools, snuffs out the screen and is able to get him down.
McKenzie started his collegiate career at Michigan State. Left there, worked for a year, went to Iowa State, then had family issues. Had to return here to the Tampa Bay area, then enrolled at South Florida. So he's played at three different Division I schools. Rojas punts. And it bounces out of bounds at the 34. 40-yard kick. Selby and the Bulls back within seven midway through the third quarter. Garcia given the hook after 1 week by John Gruden, and Brian Greasy will start this week. Jamar Taylor on first down for South Florida, yard, and that's all. They rushed for 49 yards on their last drive, thanks largely to Taylor. They had 32 yards rushing as a team in the entire first half. So much improved on the ground here at the beginning of the second half.
You know, knowing Jim Leavitt, I got to believe he went in there at halftime and challenged their toughness. And they've responded so far. Kansas has not responded to the counterpunch at the Bulls' throne, but I expect Kansas will as the game progresses.
Rothy to Jesse Hester. About three short of the first down, tackled by James Holt. These two coaches are familiar with each other. Jim Leavitt in his 12th year at South Florida. Mark Mangino in his seventh year as head coach at Kansas, but they were assistants together for 5 years in the early and mid 90s under Bill Snyder at Kansas State on a great coaching staff. They remain friends. They have a lot of respect for each other. Rothy throws, first down. Hester to the 45-yard line. Mike and Bob Stoops are also on that staff. And Mark Mangino said all those guys keep in touch. Since kind of the alumni club, we all pull for each other when we're not playing each other.
Oh yeah, I think they're bonds that are built through coaching staff. Those guys spend more time with each other than they do with their wife and kids.
There's Taylor running right, has a blocker, has a first down, has the sideline, has a touchdown, but they're going to mark him out, I believe. One of the officials on the sideline waving his hands over his head, and he's way back up the field at the 33-yard line.
This is a product of not playing a lot of football. You have to know where you are on the football field. He has the corner right there, just outrun Isaiah Barfield.
Yep, looked like the left foot was out there, and you see the official spotting it.
Freshman Isaiah Barfield taking a poor angle and learning with speed. He's about in his first start as a Kansas Jayhawk.
It is a first down and a 20-yard gain, but not a 53-yard touchdown. And you wonder now if there's a challenge. Nope. Back judge ran in. Scott Vaughn to talk with John Bible. And now they wind the clock. 5:35 remaining third quarter. Rothy through the hands of Carlton Mitchell. He's from an athletic family. His mom, Angela, has worked as a, I'm going to say cut man, but she'd be a cut woman for the professional boxer Antonio Tarver. And Carlton was at the fight when Tarver beat Roy Jones back in 2004.
I'm sure she probably takes care of some of his bumps and bruises.
Carlton from right here in the Tampa Bay area. Richard Kelly now in at running back. There'll be a pump fake. Zips one. Incomplete. Looking again for Mitchell. Boxed away by Philip Strozier, who's their fifth defensive back. Sophomore out of Kansas City, who had a couple of interceptions, the first two of his career in their season opener against FIU.
This is the velocity right here. This ball is a strike. Mitchell has to come up with that football. It'd be a tough catch, but that ball hits him in the hands. Could have called a face mask, or you said, Sean, pass interference on the shoulder.
He had a grasp of the shoulder of Mitchell before the ball got there. So a third down and 10. Probably not in field goal range, you would think, for the freshman. They're not going to have to worry about that. First down to Hester. He's becoming more of a target here in the third quarter.
You can see the comfort level that's growing between Hester and Matt Grothy. Anytime there's a go-to down, important down, Jesse Hester finds himself on the receiving end of a Grothy fastball.
Seventh catch of the night for Hester. Dad played at Florida State in the NFL, but Florida State did not recruit Jesse Hester Jr. Jamar Taylor stopped immediately, and we're under 5 minutes to go in the third quarter. Kansas led by 10 at the half. Their lead has dwindled to 7 after a field goal from South Florida here in the third quarter.
Got a guy down. I don't know if it's a heat. Hopefully it's a heat-related problem right there. Taylor missed the block of Busby. They brought the tight end across the line of scrimmage to have a little trap. And Taylor, if he would have opened his vision a little bit, he had a giant hole to run through. Get a number on that young man down there.
It's the center, Jake Griffin. Excellent center. He's now sitting up. Rick's one of the leaders on this offensive unit, making his 18th career start tonight.
I think Greg Gregory called him the best center in the Big East, and watching film, he's a really good football player snapping that ball.
Hopefully he's going to be all right. Might just be a cramp. He does not appear to be in excruciating pain. We'll take the timeout. And we'll try a shotgun snap to Grothy. Five wide receivers on second and 10 from the 21. Grothy going for the end zone. It is. Juggling. Is it a catch? No signal. No. The official took a little time and then deemed it to be out of bounds. Torrance Johnson thought he had it. Should have had it. Got behind Justin Thornton, and it would have been a tie game.
It's a well thrown ball. You see Torrance focusing, concentrating. You got to bring that in. Ooh. Now,
well, he brought it in. Did he bring it in before he was on the end line?
Yeah, I think he did.
Yeah, the crowd thinks so too. They just saw the same replay you saw. And they just saw another replay, and now they're going crazy. And there's going to be a replay review.
He does a great job of sliding, seeing that he bobbles. I don't know if he's losing his balance, but the fact that he's sliding
and he's inbounds.
Yep.
I think that's a catch, don't you?
Absolutely.
Crowd certainly thinks so. And they're really going to go ballistic if this doesn't become a touchdown, as you can see. They have great student support here. It's a huge school, 45,000 students, many of them commuters. But their student section has more than 12,000, typically, the biggest in the Big East. They sold a record 27,000 plus season tickets here In a very short time, this program has really caught on here in the pro sports area in Tampa Bay.
Yeah, and they do a great job of promoting it around the city. See billboards of Coach Leavitt holding the Bulls sign up and the excitement on campus. It's really a program that's been growing and will continue to grow. What helps that populator?
The receiver had possession with a foot inbound.
Charlie Phillips did his job well in the replay booth. Steve McBride on the left, longtime on the field official, helping out as well. And Mark Mangino is looking at a tie game if the freshman kicker can make the extra point. And Jim Leavitt, as you can see by that expression, has learned not to take anything for granted in the kicking game this year. The extra point to tie. It's 20 apiece. Matt Crothy to Taurus Johnson. 21 yards. And it is a much different looking South Florida team here in the second half, Chris.
Well, Todd Reeson has to get it going, and the offense has to help him get it going. What I mean by that is South Florida's playing tough man-to-man defense. Those receivers need to create separation. Reeson has to deliver the ball to them. If they don't create separation, ball game South Florida.
And George Selby. And what can South Florida do to get him to be more of a factor?
Well, he's getting two guys. Now, two guys are going to stay on him because he's going to keep coming all day, Sean. And what they have to do is they got to get his buddies getting more of a pass rush. If they can play man-to-man defense, create more of a pressure with four men, they'll have Kansas where they want them. If they start playing zone and giving Reese time to throw, his guys will catch the ball, and they're great with run after catch. But I want to see the matchup in the mind in the chess game. Are they going to play man? Are they going to play zone? And it becomes athlete versus athlete. Who's better?
Well, these two teams looking for credibility, trying to back up their breakthrough seasons of last year with another big season. Plenty of talent returning on both sides. Both with aspirations of making it to a BCS Bowl, as Kansas did last year when they won the Orange Bowl. South Florida's bubble burst at midseason, where they have to be looked at as a favorite along with West Virginia to win the Big East. Good kickoff by Tichy and Marcus Herford down it. Let's send you back to the studio. Here's John Buchacross off the bench with a Sports Center right now. Pucci, thank you very much. Well, Reese Davis can't go the full 60 minutes here tonight.
Well, that's unlike Reese, but I know I like Buchacross coming out of the bullpen.
Yeah, Buchacross is a starter in any lineup. Racing comes out, flinging it, and a lot of contact and a flag, and Jim Leavitt is irate. Tyler Roberts got all tangled up with Desmond Briscoe.
Defensive pass interference, number six. A 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, first down.
I just think Tyler Roberts is reading his mail and understanding he's running a route for him. I guess right there he gave him a little push, and he didn't have to use his hands.
A little hand fighting.
He didn't have to. He had great position.
Roberts, a senior, first-year starter. He mentioned he was waiting behind Mike Jenkins and Trey Williams. They're drafted by the Cowboys and Jaguars, respectively. Big play. 15 yards to the 35. Kansas has not scored here in the second half. They had nearly a 2-1 edge in yardage in the first half. Racing on target to Wilson, who's been the star receiver tonight. His sixth catch, first of the second half. Bumped out of bounds by Carlton Williams, and Wilson gave him a little bump on the way back to the huddle.
Kansas does a good job of moving the pocket to create throwing lanes for Todd Reeson right there. Play action, roll him to the right. Free throwing lane, and he will not miss if he has space to operate in throwing lanes to throw.
Jock Crawford, the running back, takes the handoff straight ahead. First down, flag thrown in the offensive line. Jerome Murphy, the cornerback, chopped him down, but it looks like a hold.
50 on the offense. 10-yard penalty, second down.
The senior center, Ryan Cantrell, team captain. Excellent center on the watch list for the Remington Award of the best center of the country.
And right there, that's tough duty as a center. You got that guy right on top of you. He's getting off the football. He starts pushing it back. That's the only thing you can do is kind of jump on him sometimes or just kind of wall him off. Use your hands to help you protect yourself.
Late substitution as Kerry Meyer runs on. Jayhawks trying to get organized. Still plenty of time on the play clock. Fifth penalty of the night against the Hawks. 3:25 to go, third quarter. Pass batted down by Selby. Making his presence known. He went flying after that football with thoughts of an interception after the battered pass.
Well, this is the only way to defend a quick three-step drop. Remember, that ball wants to be out 1.5 seconds. George Selby getting his hands up on the three-step drop on the screen. They try to neutralize his pass rush by running screen to his side. It's nothing to do with it. If I can't get the tackle or the sack, I'll get the blocked shot.
Crowd fully engaged now. Third down and 11. Racing again, trying to get them organized. Heavy rush, and they finally get to him. The ball's out. It's ruled an incomplete pass. And it was Selby at long last getting to the quarterback.
Sean, the coaches were telling him, George, keep working. You're getting there. You're getting there. You're going to beat a double team. How you beat a double team? You split a double team. First of all, you got spikes laid off the ball. Then you have Crawford coming up there getting in the pillow fight. George says, I'll beat the guy laid off the ball. I'll be more physical with the running back, and I will finish the play and come with passion and vengeance. It's about time, George.
Very determined on that pass rush. Alonso Rojas. Room to return for Marcus Edwards. There wasn't a white shirt within 10 yards of when he caught it, but excellent coverage by Holt. Mentioned they put more starters on punt coverage after the problems they had early in the season. Holt's a starter at linebacker, and he went running down to hold it to a 6-yard return of a 43-yard punt. Rob?
Sean, an unbelievable emotion down here on the USF sideline as Selby came off the sideline. He was obviously happy, but it was more like a team celebration saying, yeah, finally our star was able to break through and react and get to something. This whole place lit up. The calmest guy off the field is the quarterback right now, Grothy.
And he steps into a throw, first down, 43-yard line, Taurus Johnson again. Well, Kansas controlled the first half, but it's been all South Florida in the first 12 minutes of this third quarter.
Sean, doesn't it seem like South Florida has that 10 or 15 yard dig anytime they want it? To me, if they're a zone, the linebackers aren't getting deep enough or wide enough. You got to start reading the routes and start playing the routes as opposed to covering dirt.
Excellent Kansas defense. 9 starters back from that team that was fourth in the country in scoring defense last year. And they smothered Grothy for a 1-yard loss. Russell Brorson, veteran senior from Stillwater, Oklahoma, making his 24th straight start at defensive end. Very bright young man. Clint Bowen, the defensive coordinator, calls him the team brainiac.
Yeah, said he doesn't even look like a football player, but what'd he say? I wouldn't trade him for any other guy.
Yep, said he doesn't have a lot of ability. He's slow, he's not big. But we wouldn't give him away for anybody. Second and 11. Rofu, sideline, man open, first down. And another run after the catch. Marcus Edwards spun his way down to the 37 of the Jayhawks. 22 yards to the delight of the big crowd here at Ray J.
Well, here's the patience of Matt Grothy. Right here, he can tuck and run. Look at this space. See that throwing lane? But he stays and lets his receivers do the work downfield and get the ball into the hands of my playmakers. Just like he did there.
Florida trying to take the lead for the first time tonight. Grothy saw a seam. First down. Inside the 15. James Holt able to run him down. 24 yards for Grothy.
Same idea, but they're in man coverage. So when you're in man coverage, the defender's backs are turned. You see Mitchell running the corner off right there, which leaves a three running lane for Matt Grothy, and all he has to do is put him up, put him back down, and gain positive yards with his feet.
45 yards rushing, including a 28-yard touchdown run. A little misdirection to Taylor. Touchdown, and the lead for the first time tonight for USF.
Sean, the play that was called back, same play right here. Watch Cedric Hill right there getting the block to spring Taylor. And this time he stays in bounds for the Bulls.
The freshman Bonani adds the extra point. South Florida with a big boost from their fourth string tailback, Jamar Taylor, has outscored Kansas 17-0 here in the third quarter. Well, this is one of the marquee matchups of the weekend. There is one giant celebration here at Raymond James Stadium right now with a dramatic momentum shift. And Tichy showing the adrenaline rush. No chance for Marcus Herford to bring it out. Well, it's hard to see this coming. There is a flag down, and you wonder if they were offside again because it's back at the 30-yard line from which they kicked off. And John Bible asking Mark Mangino if he wants the ball at the 25-yard line again.
Offside, kicking team number 35. 5-yard penalty be added to the touch box, back to spot. First and 10 on the 25-yard line.
Chris, as I was starting to say before the penalty, it's really hard to see this coming. I mean, it looked like Kansas had the game going exactly as it wanted in the first half and that they were the better team.
Well, the only conclusion I can make is that Jim Leavitt at halftime got in the face of his Bull team and said enough's enough. What we're going to do is come out and get physical, establish a run. That's why their offense is going. It's because they've been able to run the football with Taylor.
Offensive formation.
Substitution.
It's a 5-yard penalty.
And the third quarter misery continues for the Jayhawks. Racing through 17 completions for Coach Mangino in the first half. He's completed only two passes here in the third quarter. And a heavy rush. Boo, did not get him down. And gets back into the play to help gang sack Racing. Bowie, who plays at the opposite end for Selby in two games as a starter, with all the focus on Selby, did not have a single tackle. And Wally Burnham said sooner or later Bowie's going to make a play, and he did there.
Well, he needed to, and he was energized by George Selby because that's the fastest that Bowie came off the ball all night. Big screen down for Kansas right here.
Second and 20. Dumped off short. They saw it coming. Tyrone McKenzie right there to greet Angus Quigley.
Well, they tried this play on Tyrone twice, and so far Tyrone's twice it. Second and 20. Automatic screen alert. George Selby forcing the throw. Tyrone beating the block of the big offensive tackle and making a secure tackle.
McKenzie, a great student of football. Wally Burnham says he spends as much time watching film in their offices as any player they've coached. End of the third quarter. Dominated by South Florida, they've taken a 7-point lead. Heading to the fourth quarter in Tampa. South Florida with a 7-point lead. They outscored Kansas 17-0 in the third quarter. Gain them 207-13 in the third. Racing a deep ball up for grabs and incomplete. Thielen a double coverage intended for Desmond Briscoe. Nate Allen and Jerome Murphy were right there for South Florida. Might as well throw it up for grabs on third down and long. It would have been just like a punt anyway.
Yeah, take your shot down the field. You might want to get an interference call. And the difference has been, Sean, there's no separation created from the Kansas wide receivers from the Bull defensive backs. And plus, they're one-dimensional. They have no running game whatsoever as far as the Jayhawks are concerned.
Marcus Edwards back for the kick from Alonzo Rojas. This one not as good as his previous efforts. Edwards from the 45. Couple of nifty moves, a hard-earned four-yard return before Raymond Brown got him down. 41-yard boot. Flag down, back near the line of scrimmage. A personal foul against the Jayhawks.
Personal foul, hands to the face, 49 on the kicking team. That's a 15-yard penalty, free kick.
Tell you that coming back out after covering a punt, I know from experience that when you have to cover two punts in a row, it takes your wind a little bit.
They're going to add the yardage to the end of the run. It wasn't a very good punt, and it'll give them great field position at the 36-yard line. Here comes Matt Brophy. All of a sudden, he's the quarterback star of the night. 26 out of 39 for 247 yards. He's thrown for a touchdown. He's run for a touchdown. He has 45 yards on the ground.
Really a tough kid, competitor. Didn't go well the first half. Doesn't seem to be bothered. Came out the second half and lightened it up.
Trying to run. Looking for a block from the tight end, Cedric Hill. Isaiah Barfield, a nice play with help from Joe Mortensen, and a loss of about a yard or two. There's the score that tied the game. It was reviewed on instant replay and deemed a touchdown by Torres Johnson. And Jamar Taylor, who was certainly a big part of their turnaround in the third quarter, ran it in to give them their first lead of the night. Trailed by 10 on a couple of occasions. Good throw, catch, touchdown, right on the money. Brophy to A.J. Love. They beat the new starter, Isaiah Barfield. To the 14-point lead. Stunning turn of events here in Tampa. 14 minutes to go and a 14-point lead for the home team. Matt Brophy's second touchdown pass of the night. 37-yarded A.J. Love has given South Florida a two-touchdown lead. First touchdown catch of the year for Love. Second of his career. He had one as a freshman last year in the Sun Bowl against Oregon. Peachy's been booming them into the end zone. This one not as deep. Into the breeze here in the fourth quarter. But spirited coverage, and Herford knocked down at the 22 by Alonzo McQueen.
Well, here we have two deep, Sean, and what you want to do if you're him, the corner Barfield, you want to force the receiver inside to your help, the safety man sitting right there. And what you see is he lets him outside. That way he's on the island, and the safety Thornton has no angle to help him. Executed read well by Matt Worthy and delivers to A.J. Love in beating cover two.
And Love is in the end zone.
Yes, sir.
Now Reason hitting him back in the end zone for the first time in this second half. Still a very long way to go, nearly 14 minutes. Five receivers. Short throw and catch to Kerry Meyer. And it appears tonight that the Jayhawks miss Dexton Fields, their senior leading wide receiver the last 2 years. Injured in the opener, an apparent left leg injury. Didn't play last week and isn't playing tonight. They expect to have him back soon, maybe even next week. Well, they could use Fields tonight. One more very talented weapon at wide receiver. Reising under duress, threw it away. They've gotten a lot closer to him in this half. Carlton Williams, the safety, came on a blitz.
Well, yeah, and the other thing is there's no threat of run. So Wally, the defensive coordinator, tore him up in the dirt and said, look, there's no threat of run. You guys don't worry about it. Pin your ears back. I'll blitz him because we're handling him man-to-man, athlete versus athlete. We're winning.
At one point, they were 4 out of 5 on third down. They failed to convert in the last 7. Racing in trouble. Got away and connects to Meyer for a first down. And that's been the case throughout this young season. Meyer had 18 catches in the first 2 ball games, 9 in each game, and 13 of those 18 went for first downs.
Jarrett Bowie had a chance to make a play. You can't expect guys to stay man-to-man that long. Jarrett Bowie has to finish the play.
Oh. That time was George Selde who knocked it down and almost finished the play with an interception. He gets a pat on the head, a head that has a dent in it, a story we'll tell in a moment.
He had a second block shot right there. Instead of continuing his pass rush, reading the eyes of Reising and getting his hands up.
Second and 10. 4 wide receivers. Angus Quigley the back. 13 minutes to go. Racing steps up through a wobbler that was caught by Meyer for another first down to the South Florida 43. When we visited with George Selby yesterday, you could see quite clearly he has a big scar on the side of his head, the left side of his head, and an indentation in his head. And that came as a result of a collision with a car when he was an infant. Meyer to the 35-yard line. He's going to come out of the game now. He was at the family home. There's the scar and the indentation. As a 1-year-old, he was at home, his grandfather working on a car that accidentally got knocked into gear by a young cousin, and the tire of the car ran right over his head. You can imagine his mom, Twana, who was 9 months pregnant at the time, horrified. They rushed him to the hospital. He had reconstructed surgery on his skull. The skin peeled back. He was fortunate to survive. Spent a week in the hospital. Racing throws. First down. The result of that injury suffered as a 1-year-old. His helmet doesn't fit, and that frequently frustrates him. His mom went into the same hospital room and gave birth to his sister Heather. They were in the same room for a week.
I got to give credit to you, Sean. You were trying to get the story from George.
Angus Quigley carries. Yeah, George didn't know any of the details. I mean, he was 1. He doesn't remember it. So he said, I'll call my mom. He put Twana on the phone with us yesterday from Pensacola. She made the 6.5-hour drive down today to be at the game. She's probably telling somebody, yep, they're talking about me, because I talked to those wacky announcers yesterday and told them about where old George got his head run over.
And she remembered it quite clear.
Yeah, the grandfather and another relative pulled the driver's side of the car up in the air to get his head free from underneath the tire. Apparently strength runs in the family. The dad, George, a military man, now retired in Pensacola. Second and 9. McKenzie on a blitz. Reising a la Fran Tarkenton. And it'll depend on the spot. I don't think Wilson got to that yellow line, but he's close. Well, they're going to put it right down on the line. And if that line is accurate, as it almost always is, it'll be a first down for Kansas, thanks to Todd Reason.
Oh, this is just great awareness right here. A little spin move. McKenzie had him in his sights. And Reason with the fadeaway, trusting his receivers to work back to the football. The See, Wilt's coming back, working back to the football and favorable spot.
Yeah, how do you get a spot on the yellow line? Yeah, that wasn't even close. Not like he was driven back. He circled back. Took himself back from the yellow line. And then they put it back on the line. And as I said, that yellow line's always right on the money, isn't it?
Two links short.
Those two jack links?
Yes, I was just, you beat me to it. Which I'm enjoying my teriyaki beef jerky jack links up here in the booth during breaks. Not sharing.
No, second week in a row. You've polished off the bag by yourself.
Just getting in touch with my wild side, man.
I am withholding any possible comments that are running through my head right now. Big play, third down and a couple of links. Probably in four down territory with under 11 minutes to go. They stick with the 5'11", 200-pound Reesing. And he got the first down near the 21.
You know what I love about both quarterbacks is their composure in making plays. They might not make plays five or six in a row, but all of a sudden they come out and make a huge play, just like Reesing made, as you mentioned, I mentioned, a la Fran Tarkenton, scrambling around, spinning, and throwing off the back foot for a big conversion.
Kansas led by 10 at the half. They've been outscored 24-0 here in the second half, trying to score. Briscoe driven back, bounced off a hit or two, went out of bounds at the 18. A very tough two-yard gain. Louis Gachette, backup safety, knocked him out of bounds.
Briscoe slow getting up, looking like cramps. He's been kind of quiet tonight. Carlton Williams comes up. He has a chance to blast him. You better take him down because he'll hurt you.
These are two quarterbacks who both might have earned their way into the Heisman Trophy talk with their performances tonight. Similar numbers, similar ability. Reesing throws, first down, and then Meyer, nope, it popped out. Knocked out by Murphy. And Meyer's checking to make sure all his teeth are still in place. That's a huge and potentially very important hit because it prevented a first down, at least for the moment.
Well, a rare creature in football is a corner that's physical. And right there is a corner that's physical.
I think that was a catch. I mean, he caught it, turned, and took a step or two, and then the ball got jarred out. And there's going to be a review. I think that was a catch. It was a wallop delivered by Murphy, the junior from Elizabeth, New Jersey. That's a catch, and he ran two steps with it. Unless he was juggling it while he was running.
Let's see, it looks like he has it secure.
Yeah, that ball's put away.
Man, he's coming with some passion in there to take him out. I was hearing some South Florida coaches talking about at halftime how their two corners, Roberts and Murphy, had to play better. And Sean, I'll tell you what, they've answered the challenge. Both of them have played extremely well in the second half.
When the official ruled it incomplete there, the head linesman Al Green, you know, he couldn't see if that ball was being juggled because, you know, the back of Meyer was turned to him and the ball was in front of him. This is a very important replay review. With 9:59 to go. Terry Meyer, the former quarterback. Does not sit in any of the wide receiver meetings. Apparently they're having communication problems with the replay booth.
After review, the play stands as called on the field.
Well, apparently it wasn't conclusive enough for the replay booth to overturn it. That's Wally Burnham, veteran assistant coach, the defensive coordinator, does a great job. And if he wants his players to be tough, they can follow his example. He took a shot in the eye yesterday to deal with a tear behind his retina. A needle.
Right. He's supposed to be wearing sunglasses.
Third down and seven. Reesing. points, throws, touchdown, Jonathan Wilson. He is Fran Tarkenton, the second.
I mean, what do you say about the kid? Never panics, eyes down the field. And my problem is on the back end for South Florida, when you have a quarterback scrambling, you have to go look people up. The zone is off. You start going to cover people, and you see Wilson, he's back there all alone in the end zone with nobody on him. When a quarterback scrambles, start hugging people up.
Wilson's huge night continues. 9 catches, 160 yards, 2 touchdowns. Todd Reising, the touchdown. His only other scholarship offer out of high school was from Duke. Many thought he was too small. So much for that. It is a terrifying prospect as it makes its way toward the coast. One touchdown game as Jacob Brandstetter kicks off, and a good one with the wind. And South Florida will begin at the 20. Reising now over 300 yards passing after this improvisational touchdown throw.
This is a move he likes, just throwing off the back foot, keeping his eyes down the field. Receivers just keep working. As a defensive back, you got to find open people, not cover the dirt. As soon as that scramble happens by the quarterback, they call it scramble drill. Go lock on somebody. The zone's off. Start playing man.
Career night for Jonathan Wilson. 312 yards passing to Reising, his 8th straight game of 200 yards passing or more. That's a Kansas record. He owns 23 Jayhawk quarterback records. And James Holt dropped Jamar Taylor for a loss. Taylor's been a big key to their rally here in the second half for Jim Leavitt. He's had 68 yards rushing all in the second half on just 8 carries.
Yeah, and I tell you, James Holt, Sean, probably the most underheralded of the Kansas linebackers, is really playing well tonight, not only on defense but on special teams.
Matt Grothy jumps it off short. Whoa. That could be a costly stumble by Cedric Hill. He had a lot of running room, but tripped and fell at the 29, a yard short of the first down.
Well, it's a matchup that they wanted. You had Cedric Hill on Rivera, the linebacker. Cedric gave him a little stutter and go. If he catches the ball, he's turning the corner, and I don't think Rivera was going to catch him.
Now they're in a third down and one. Trying to reclaim the momentum, the crowd suddenly silent and anxious after that impressive drive by the Kansas Jayhawks to get back within a score. 8.5 minutes to go, a blitz. Grothy lost the football. And one of the offensive linemen, I believe, got it back at the 12-yard line. But it's a big loss on the play as Mortensen and Holt, the linebackers, came blitzing after Grothy, and that stumble was huge on the previous play.
Actually, they do a decent job of picking up the blitz, but give the assist on the sack to the Kansas secondary, who locked down every eligible Bull wide receiver. He has time to get rid of that football. He didn't.
Cedric Hill recovered the Grothy fumble. That could be a very costly stumble he had on the prior play. Alvarado with a short punt. The freshman Patterson, a fair catch at the 46. Actually, it turned out to be a pretty good punt. 41 yards. Let's check in with Rob Stone.
Sean, it's so interesting to watch the pendulum of emotion swing and how it plays out on the sidelines. You know, before that touchdown drive, Coach Mangino really continually was addressing his offense, addressing his kickoff return team. There was a calmness on the Kansas sideline, but it was one of those, whoa, what happened calmness, but it was calm nonetheless. That entire drive, energy picked up, but still calm, in control. And remember when Selby got that hit on the QB, the USF bench exploded? Same thing happened when Grothy just took that hit on the Kansas sideline.
Tight formation now. Two receivers on either side of Reising, all close to the line. Here's Wilson again. Mammoth night for Jonathan Wilson. He goes into USF territory all the way to the 35-yard line. His 10th catch of the night, 179 yards receiving after a 19-yard pickup.
Kansas up in the tempo here.
With momentum, it seems, back on their side. Midway through the fourth quarter, down by seven. Racing, running away from the All-American Selby. Throws on the run and turned it into a one-yard gain.
That's a lot of work.
And Selby's going to be exhausted. He bulked up, gained weight with an amazing diet that will be chronicled in the next edition of ESPN the magazine. The writer Wright Thompson spent time with Selby trying to eat as much as George did, and he couldn't keep up with it.
Yeah, I don't know if he works out like George or chases Reese around like George has been doing tonight, burning those calories.
George has bulked up to 245 pounds. Here he comes again, and he just did get racing by the shoe top. His long-awaited first sack of the season after 14 and a half last year.
And what happens is Jeff Spikes is also getting tired because he's standing straight up in the stance. George Selby still is like a sprinter, an Olympic sprinter, coming off that ball. And Spikes has no shot when Selby's got that speed going. And the big fella is struggling as far as oxygen goes, that offensive tackle.
Third down, 21. Tentative rush by Selby, and the catch made by Meyer. Right down the numbers to the 19-yard line on third and 21. They convert on a 27-yard play.
Not one rusher. They all stood up. Now, I don't know if they were looking for screen or what, but third and 21. And you got him on the edge, you got to run.
Flags down and whistle stopped the play. Meyer, as we mentioned, had 18 catches in the first two games, nine in each, but the longest catch was 16 yards. He's a possession receiver running short routes. That was a huge time to have his longest catch of the year. 27 yards on third and 21, now the flag.
Number seven, illegal substitution on the defense. 12 players in the defensive formation. That's a 5-yard penalty, first down.
Well, you're not cheating, you're not trying.
Well, but that's a cause by Kansas was hurrying up, understanding that South Florida wanted to get fresh pass rushers in there. Kansas runs the football, snaps the ball while they're trying to substitute.
Selby has come off the field. First and five, Kansas hoping for the tying score. Racing, shovel pass, great call, Quigley, first down, Quigley, touchdown! What a great play call by Ed Warner and beautifully executed by Racing and Quigley.
Right here, Ryan Cantrell, the center, chops down Bruce Montpremier. And Quigley, with fresh legs, shows the power and enthusiasm and a want to get into the end zone. Sprung by Ryan Cantrell, the tough center for the Jayhawks.
Now the critical extra point by Brandstetter, kicking in just his second game, and he's right down the middle. Give the Jayhawks credit. Everything had turned against them. They were down by 14. And they scored two unanswered touchdowns. We're tied at 34 with 5.5 to go. Well, what a night for Todd Reesing. It's been an up and down ride, but all of a sudden they're tied at 34 again. And his team dominated the first half. Got badly outplayed through the first part of the second half, outscored 17 to nothing in the third quarter. Trailed by 14 points, but they've scored two unanswered touchdowns. And right now in the game, as the kickoff is muffed by Dontavia Bogan, the difference in total yardage, despite all these twists and turns and momentum shifts, is 1 yard. Kansas has 409, South Florida 408.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a team game, but both teams have great leaders and competitors at quarterback. In fact, when coaching staffs from both teams were asked to describe the opposing quarterback. Both of them agreed, competitor, competitor, and not used lightly. Real competitors.
Well, these at Sandlot football. It is reminiscent of Doug Flutie or Fran Tarkenton with these two smallish quarterbacks. Brophy throws, man open, caught, first down. Marcus Edwards had to wait for him for a moment and got banged around after the catch by Isaiah Barfield, but he held on for a 24-yard gain. First down.
The coach needs to tell Isaiah Barfield that in cover two, let the people in front of you go. The longer he holds that ball, the more depth as a corner you have to get to help your safety, because your safety's out on an island.
Barfield made his first career start. There's Taylor. Kendrick Harper, their starter cornerback, injured and not available tonight. Of course, they're adjusting to life without Aqib Talib in that secondary, the All-American cornerback at KU last year. First round pick of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. 20th player taken in the draft overall. Talib is here tonight. He's been on the sideline. Darryl Stuckey, let's hope that's just a cramp. On a very hot and humid night, Clint Bowen, the defensive coordinator, says that Stuckey's been their best defensive player through the first two games of the season. Voted the nicest guy on the team by his teammates. We asked him, you know, how do you get to be the nicest guy on the team? He said, well, I try to always have a smile on my face, always be available for my teammates, and set a great example by working hard all the time.
Yeah, and also producing on the football field. That's what gets the respect of your teammates. Then you add on top of that, you have the perfect football player by being a nice guy in the locker room, being a leader.
Communication studies major, wants to be a broadcaster. We could use a few more nice guys in broadcasting. So there you go. Now we are in a business populated solely by good folks. It looks like he'll be back quickly. Patrick Resby, number 7, is in for him. Second down and 8. And is it a catch? Yes. And a low throw by Grothy. Carlton Mitchell scooped it off the grass just inside Kansas territory. And the clock becoming a factor. Under 4.5 minutes to go. Each team in possession of all 3 timeouts.
Yeah, Grothy was kind of kicking himself a little bit there. He should have put the ball in a place where Mitchell would have room to work instead of going down, putting a knee on the ground to catch the football.
Yeah, saw a stumble cost him an important first down on the last possession. That low throw from the moment has cost them the first down. Will they pick it up against the blitz? Yes, they do. It's the tight end Hill sliding to the 41-yard line. Philip Strozier, the stop for the Hawks.
And Philip Strozier coming in is playing man-to-man on Cedric Hill. And he's not tight enough. When you got 3rd and 4, you can't be playing 7 yards off the field. You got to get up there and press. And Cedric Hill reads the chains. And Matt Grothy just waits for him to beat him man-to-man across the field and delivers the football in good protection by the Bull offensive line.
Two teams trying to make a statement, trying to back up their breakthrough seasons of last year. Taylor can't turn the corner, gets a yard as he slipped through the hands of Jill Mortensen. And I think what we've learned tonight as we look at the freshman kicker Bonani, who could be at the center of the drama shortly. These are both very good teams. I mean, these are both teams that are going to contend for their conference titles and perhaps a BCS bowl game.
And I think a game like this, Sean, prepares them for that shot at the conference. And we know Bonani has the range of around 50 yards at least, according to Jim Leavitt.
They prefer a touchdown and plenty of time to get that done. Grothy steps up from the rush. It might have been across the line of scrimmage when he threw it to Carlton Mitchell. There is a flag down. He was across the line of scrimmage. And it'll come back.
Illegal forward pass. The quarterback was beyond the line of scrimmage. That's a 5-yard penalty. It's also loss of down. 5 yards from the spot of the foul.
And here, Matt Grothy gonna make a decision. Just tuck it and run right here. I know it's close.
Yeah, he's across that blue line, which represents the line of scrimmage. And as you heard John Bible say, lost it down as well. So it's going to be 3rd down.
Quarterback was beyond the line of scrimmage when he threw the pass.
think you're going to lose that one, Jim. It was close, but it looked like he was across, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. And again, I think Matt has to have the decision to go ahead and tuck it and run it and get what you can get, although he's trying to make a play.
Yeah, right there, he's on it, but it looks like by the time the ball leaves his possession, he's across the line. Again, it has to be conclusive to overturn the call on the field, and I don't know how you could say he was conclusively behind the line of scrimmage based on what we've seen.
No, not from that angle. You got to believe that they had the better angle right there on the field, and nothing conclusive tells me that he was behind the line of scrimmage when he let the football go.
And John Bible, the referee, leading a Big 12 on-field officiating crew. Charlie Phillips, the replay booth. From the Big East, apparently the headset is working. It was not.
After review, the play stands as called on the field. South Florida is charged with a timeout.
Here's Steve McBride again. Charlie Phillips, I believe, is what would be on the left part of your screen there. Here he is. Veteran replay official, does a great job. We have a new supervisor in the Big East this year. Terry McCauley, who's an NFL referee. Working with Nick Carparelli, Mike Trangisi, and the great administration of the Big East Conference. Always striving to make their officials better.
Absolutely. I think you can say that about all conferences. They work very hard and take a lot of pride in the job that they do.
That's a big play. Third down and 11 now. Call it 12. From the 44, just a four-man rush from Kansas. And Grody had time. He throws short of the first down. A.J. Love down to the 39. And now a decision for Jim Leavitt. Fourth down. And they still have a good 4 yards to go, maybe even a little more than that.
Be a 53-yard field goal if they decided that. A lot of pressure on the freshman.
It looks like he's going to send the punt team up.
I think that's a good decision. The way Kansas has moved the football, you don't want to give them a short field to work with.
And it's almost 5 yards to go. Looks like they'll take the delay of game penalty. That's not a big deal.
Yard penalty, fourth down.
I think it's the right choice, Sean. I really do.
I do too. It's too far to go for the first down. It's too long for a field goal into the wind for a freshman kicker. And the field position will be too good for Kansas with the way they function on offense tonight.
Absolutely, and that's the main decision. I think you got to give your defense a chance to win.
Alvarado hoping for a soft bounce, and he gets a great bounce. It'll be down near the 5.
Let's go.
They're going to spot the ball at the 7-yard line. Last year, a historic season for Kansas with 12 wins. Mark Mangino, the National Coach of the Year, turned it around. Here's tonight's coach talk, brought to you by Liberty Mutual. He uttered one of the great quotes we've read in a long time, talking about the history of Kansas football. Anybody can have a bad century.
He's got it turned around this century, I know that. Another reason why you punt the football, field position.
Look out, shovel pass with Selby bearing it on racing. Angus Quigley fought hard to get across the line of scrimmage, and that's all. And that challenge by Jim Leavitt that cost them a timeout. I mean, if you pin Kansas down here, you would want to use your timeouts, and there's one less to work with.
And again, right here, Bruce Montpremier on the same play that they scored the touchdown was not going to be blocked there and stuffing the play with pressure from Selby.
1:25 to go. Racing throws quickly. Meyer did not get to the first down marker, but he's within a yard. Jerome Murphy chopped him down at the 17-yard line. Kansas looking to convert. Third down. They get it. Boy, Reese is small, but he is tough.
Yeah, he got that on his own. Initially, he was stopped. And I don't think he weighs 200 pounds, Sean, but he plays like he's 220 and 6'4". I tell you, there might be quarterbacks as good as him in college football, but there aren't any that are better, in my opinion.
Well, it is remarkable the arm strength given his size. And he's as smart as anybody, that's for sure, both on and off the field. Great maneuverability. And what is he lacking? Sure, you'd like him to be 6'4", 6'5", but doesn't seem to be hindering him, especially with this style that they play.
Yeah, and he's been a 5'11 quarterback his whole life, so he's used to finding throwing lanes. And Ed Warner, the offensive coordinator, does a great job of moving that pocket and giving him throwing lanes to work with.
First Mon Premier comes off. Let's see if they get a bit more aggressive now. The field position still poor at the 18. Racing steps up and runs and heads for the sideline and takes a hit from Murphy. It was legal. He wasn't across the boundary yet. Murphy trying to get there to keep him in bounds. Racing went out, just a 2-yard gain, and the prospect of overtime lingering with each tick of the clock.
I love Murphy taking a shot because a lot of times the quarterback thinks the defender will let up. Sometimes you can jar that ball loose.
They're at the 20. All three timeouts left for KU. Racing incomplete. Ball that should have been caught off the hands of Briscoe. He's had an indifferent night tonight. Just three catches. A chance to make a couple plays he hasn't made. He's a very talented sophomore out of Dallas.
Jonathan Wilson has kind of taken up and become the big time receiver. Briscoe still dangerous. You have to keep a count on him. Very dangerous, especially after he gets the ball in his hands.
Third down's a story all night long. Racing's now 34 out of 50 for 381. Third down and 8. They're 9 out of 17 on third down. They're 10 out of 18. And Quigley keeps on running. All the way to the 40. And Mark Mangino wants to use one of those three timeouts. 20-yard gain.
You know, you got to have the feeling that they're either going to run a short screen or run the football trying to pop one, because if they don't get the first down, at least the clock keeps running. Right here, Quigley with fresh legs. Again, a nice job of chipping down and getting to the next level by Chet Hartley, the offensive guard, springing Quigley for the first down. But Murphy had a chance to bring him, but what'd he do? He hit him hard. But you're not going to bring down the big fella if you don't wrap him up.
There's Aqib Talib. First round draft pick of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Mark Mangino told us, I think Aqib's called me about 10 times when he's going to have a field pass for the game. Obviously got it. And now Brandstetter warming up for his chance to be the hero, perhaps.
And we talked to the coaches about his range, and the rain at Kansas before they left, they said it was about from 46, 47 yards.
Transfer from the Air Force Academy, had some transcript questions that needed to be cleared up, and he didn't become eligible till last week. Heavy rush, racing down the field, intercepted.
Got a wall.
Nate Allen with blockers. He's inside the 30. He's in field goal range and out of bounds. They'll mark him out at the 27. Yard return of just the second interception of the season for the South Florida defense.
We're getting greedy right here. Allen just playing center field. Racing doesn't see him. Trying to strike gold. Keep the ball in play. Move it. Don't force anything. The first big mental error he made tonight, and it could be the costly one.
Now they're in field goal range, so no reason to be bold with the play calling here. And Jamar Taylor goes right into the line. James Holt, the tackle. Jim Leavitt. The field goal's a problem all season long. He's going to let it run down and call a timeout. Taylor limps off. His field goal kicker to start the year was Delbert Alvarado, doubles as the punter, but he went 1-for-4. So during the week, Coach Leavitt made the decision to turn it over to a true freshman, highly recruited, Maicon Bonani, native of Brazil, moved to Lake Wales, Florida when he was 11, All-State field goal kicker and punter here in Florida last year. Missed his first one badly as a collegian at the start of this game. Hooked a 41-yarder from the right hash mark, well left, but has been right on the money with the last two.
Yeah, and the second one was on the money, but it was fading toward the left. So if he misses, usually he might try to over-kick it. He will miss left. He's either going to make it or miss left, but I think he's relaxed. It's a chance. Coach Leavitt's taking a chance on him. Let's see if that gamble pays off for the Bulls.
Here's Rob.
Well, Sean, on that last drive when they decided to punt it, USF, we're talking about, there was some serious headwind coming in. The wind has died down significantly since then. If anything, it's going more across the field from USF towards the Kansas side.
Bonani lining up, a 43-yard attempt, basically in the middle of the field. In his first college game as the kicker, trying to beat Mark Mangino's Jayhawks. And Kansas will use the timeout to try to make the young man think about it. Has a very strong leg, kicked a 55-yard field goal in high school. Soccer star.
What an opportunity for him, huh? Just a Friday night football, national television, a chance to be a hero as a young guy, as a freshman kicker. It's either a great story or a sad story.
It's either the winner, it's overtime.
Yep.
Last week at Central Florida, the Bulls squandered a 14-point lead in the fourth quarter, won it in overtime. Now trying to win it in regulation after blowing a 14-point lead in the fourth. The freshman Bonani, it hooks back and it is good! For Mangino and the Jayhawks, that had the game in control in the first half, it seemed. Saw that slip away, went down by two touchdowns, rallied back, only to lose it on the field goal by Bonani, who a couple of days ago was an anonymous true freshman backup kicker about whom few Bulls fans had ever heard. And after missing his first kick as a college place kicker badly, that one looked like it was hooking, going to miss it to the right, and then it hooked back.
And a nice little draw in there, didn't he, Sean?
Yeah, but it didn't look like a fade, and
no
draw.
Yeah.
And Rob talked about the shifting winds, and every time we looked up to the flag, it looked like they were blowing in a different direction. You wonder if that one got a straightening boost from the wind. Jim Leavitt said, I want anybody who can kick field goals to be our kicker. He found that man tonight, Rob.
Yeah, he's a kicking coach genius this week. Did you say anything to Bonani before he went out there?
No, you know, I didn't. I wouldn't know what to tell him, you know. I don't know. He's such a great kid. And they all are. And what a way to battle back, and Nate getting an interception. You know, I told him at halftime, they had played perfect. Kansas had. They've got to make it. Let's put them in adversity and see what they do and hopefully make a mistake. And he made a mistake. That quarterback Kansas has, awesome. awesome. Yeah, awesome.
You're telling us something we're well aware of.
Yeah.
What was the adjustment in that third quarter? A wonderful third quarter for your program.
Yeah, we played a real good third quarter. We spread out, did some things offensively. Matt got throwing the ball well. But you know what, Taylor, with those running game, you know, we did some really good things in the perimeter. I thought our offense line did a nice job. I thought Taylor was real patient in letting things set up, you know, in an outside zone, a stretch. And defensively, we made some mistakes, you know, but they're good. You know, Kansas is good.
What do you guys take away from this victory?
You know, the fight. We overtime win last week and then a battle today. And, you know, we just got a bunch of battlers. Our guys play hard.
Coach, we appreciate your time. Thanks for joining
us
live.
Okay.
Last year, some of the Bulls felt they got caught up in the hoopla. The challenge will be, as Jim Leavitt says, after a couple of heart-stopping wins, to deal with it well and move on. A much-needed lift for the Big East tonight as South Florida rallies to beat Kansas. A memorable one here in Tampa. Final score is 37-34.